Buongiorno, Giovanni.
Aerosmith, one of America's greatest rock and roll bands from the 70s and onward. There is so much that can be said about the band's dramatic rise, then fall, and then rise again that could fill books, documentaries, and movies aplenty. Today, please allow me to indulge myself in years of useless knowledge related to the Bad Boys from Boston. But first, what is an iceberg chart? Basically, for those who haven't kept up with YouTube, aka my dad, an iceberg chart is a large image comprised of different sections inside of which topics are listed based on the level of how obscure they are. The top has well-known topics, while the lower you go, the less likely common/casual fans are to know the topics listed inside the section. The bottom levels usually contain the most obscure and sometimes flat-out false or fake rumors on other iceberg videos. My videos will stray away from those types of entries due to the immense length of the video, and the majority of ones that I've seen or heard are Steven Tyler had sexual conquests with ex-celebrity. Though, if you, dear viewer, have a topic or rumor that you'd like to see in a possible follow-up, leave it below, and if the video does well, I'll make a follow-up. Going into this iceberg, I'm assuming the audience are fans of the band and have a decent understanding of the band. I'm not going to go into crazy detail on each of their popular songs except for the big three. Now enough with the pre-show, on with the main act. The Way Out of Sphere. Guitar Hero Aerosmith.
Nelson, do you have that report ready?
Steven Tyler doesn't do reports.
No!
Released in 2008, this music-based game puts you in the shoes of Aerosmith as you travel through various times in the band's career. These include their first show at Nipmuc High, Max's Kansas City, the Orpheum, Moscow, the Super Bowl in 2001, and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. The game was generally popular and considered a high-ranking game in the series. It was so popular that it has made more revenue for the band than any of their studio albums. The game even had tournaments, much like the other Guitar Hero games, and Joe Perry would play against the game version of himself during concerts on the subsequent tour.
But right here, right now, on this stage, we're going to have a little duel, and we're going to prove to you which is better, the game or the real thing.
I don't want to miss a thing. Aerosmith's first and only number one hit released alongside the movie Armageddon in 1998. Written by Diane Warren, it was originally supposed to be a radio-only single from the Armageddon album, but due to popular request, it was released and debuted at number one. The band were first unsure if they could make the song their own. When I first heard it, recalled Joey Kramer, it was just a demo of piano and singing. It was difficult to imagine what kind of touch Aerosmith could put on it and make their own. But as soon as we started playing it as a band, then it instantly became an Aerosmith song. As of now, it's been played at almost every single show since it released, and even caused the Nine Lives tour to be extended by 2 years. The song is a favorite of many weddings and love scenes, and even having a parody in Robot Chicken and being featured in the opening of Saints Row 4. Dream On. Arguably Aerosmith's most popular song, released on their first album by the band. The song was written in 1969 by Steven Tyler during his time with Chain Reaction at his home in Sunapee. The song charted well even though the first album didn't sell at all in 1973. The song is a staple of their live shows as well as being used in commercials, movies, and even being used in a Kia Super Bowl commercial. Neat tidbit, Dream On is the only song on the band's first album with Steven actually singing. All other tracks have Steven singing in a different voice due to him being insecure. He akins this voice to being somewhat of a Kermit the Frog James Brown impression. Walk This Way, one of Aerosmith's most popular songs released on the band's third album, Toys in the Attic. The riff was written during a sound check in 1974, and the title comes from the movie Young Frankenstein.
Walk this way. This way.
The band thought this line was hilarious and had to use it in a song. In 1986, the song was re-recorded featuring Run-DMC from the suggestion of Rick Rubin. The song would go on to be a huge success, and the music video received large amounts of play on MTV. This heavily influenced the revitalization of Aerosmith's career, also forming the genre of rap rock,
for better or for worse. Rock and Roller Coaster.
Opened in Walt Disney World on July 29, 1999, this Aerosmith-themed ride features a themed merch store and ride cards that play Aerosmith tunes. Riders first meet with the man in the studio, where they are invited to see the band play that night. The limo-themed car then whisks them through the streets and highways of LA to the concert. Each car you choose plays a different Aerosmith song marked by the license plate on each ride card. These songs are Young Lust, F-I-N-E, Love in an Elevator with a roller coaster variant, Dude Looks Like a Lady, Nine Lives, Walk This Way, Back in the Saddle, and the live version of Sweet Emotion that was taken from the recently released Little South of Sanity. The ride had two locations in Hollywood, California and Paris, France. However, the Paris ride no longer has an Aerosmith theme and is now under an Avengers theme as of July 22nd, 2022.
Revolution X!
Released by Midway in 1994, this smash hit arcade rail shooter featured Aerosmith getting kidnapped and the player being tasked to fight off the New World Order, whose main objective was to destroy youth culture. The game featured six stages, each with not only the objective to survive, but to also find the members hidden in each of the levels. The soundtrack features remixes of Aerosmith songs and real motion clips of the band encouraging the player to keep going.
No choice, no voice. Fight the oppression of the New Order Nation with non-stop shoot-em-up action straight from the number one arcade mega hit, Revolution X. Music is the weapon, from Acclaim.
While the arcade was a huge success, the home console versions were very lackluster. The SNES, PC, Sega Saturn / Genesis, and PS1 versions were all universally condemned for poor graphics, bad music, and awkward controls.
No trespassing.
Awesome!
There are, however, still a few cabinets still out in the wild that can be found on yourarcade.com. As of right now, there is no remaster version, but honestly, I hope that Arcade 1UP can make a remaster version for home use, as real cabinets can go for upwards of $1,000. And also, the versions that are out there right now, they're like way too far away from where I live. They're all either in like California or they're in like New Hampshire or Pennsylvania. They're like 4 or 5 hours away from me. So like, I really let me buy it in a Walmart, right? Like, just...
Toasty!
Awesome. Excellent. Excellent. All right. All right. Rock and roll!
Rock and roll!
Super Bowl 2001.
Where are my rock and rollers and out of controllers?
And I rock and
roll. Okay, that scares me.
Okay.
Can I just say that I get...
In 2001, Aerosmith performed alongside NSYNC, Britney Spears, Nelly, and Mary J. Blige at the Raymond James Stadium. It's widely considered to be one of the best Super Bowl halftimes and was also the debut of Jaded just 2 months before the album Just Push Play was released. That's it. There's no other information on it. It's go watch it.
For watching the E-Trade Super Bowl 35 halftime show.
Boston, Massachusetts. The hometown of Aerosmith. The band played many shows in clubs around Boston, such as The Club, Orpheum, Katie's, and Suffolk Down in their early days. The band also had an apartment here as well, where they stayed during a period of time when the first album was created. The band are also huge fans of the Red Sox and have played Fenway twice, once in 2010 and one in 2022. The band also had a nightclub just outside of Fenway all the way up until 1999. The band has a ton of merch calling back to Boston and even earned the nickname The Bad Boys from Boston. Diana Hall. We're going to make this short and sweet because I really don't want to drag on this one. It's going to bring the whole video down. So we're just going to boof right through this. In 1975, Steven Tyler attained guardianship of 16-year-old Diana Hall with the intention of a sexual relationship. The pair mainly did drugs while Hall stayed in the apartment in Boston. Pressures leading to their split included the age difference, which Tyler was 27 when they first met. A withdrawn marriage proposal, a house fire, and a planned pregnancy that resulted in an abortion when Tyler was worried that the fire smoke, as well as drugs, might lead to birth defects. In Tyler's book, Does the Noise in My Head Bother You?, he writes, "While I was on the road, our apartment had almost burned down, and she wound up in a hospital, and that's when reality slapped me in the face." This being uncovered in the later years helped push Tyler to open Janie's Fund, a shelter for abuse victims. It's so high on this list because of Tyler's work with the fund and the story being passed around more often in recent years, I decided not to use the actual victim's name because even though it has been found and she's come out about the experience, I've just decided to leave it as the false name because I just don't want anybody going out and bugging her. Her name is Diana Hall. That's all you need to know. Aerosmith broke up in 1979. Okay, so there's a documentary's worth of info on this topic, so just here's a quick rundown. In 1979, after a heated argument following a show, Joe Perry would leave Aerosmith. He would then be replaced by Jimmy Crespo. Then, Brad Whitford would leave the band in 1981 after recording the track for Lightning Strike. He was then replaced by Rick Dufay. Dufay and Crespo helped Aerosmith release Rock and the Hard Place in 1982 and would go on tour with them until 1984. In 1984, Perry and Whitford would rejoin Aerosmith, and that's pretty much how the lineup has stayed. Nice and simple, and we'll get to the nitty-gritty of who and why and what happened later. Simpsons appearances. The band appeared on The Simpsons in 1991, playing themselves in the episode Flaming Moe's. In the episode, Homer creates a drink that causes Moe's Bar to become extremely popular.
Hey, I know a good drink. Really hits the spot.
If you're going for a beer, this is the last one.
Dope! I decided to mix the little bits that were left in every liquor bottle. It passed the first test. I didn't go blind. Huh? I don't know the scientific explanation, but fire made it good.
To which even Aerosmith appears.
Ladies and gentlemen, some new buddies of mine stopped by tonight. Aerosmith!
Yeah, we're just hanging out.
Oh, come on, guys. Free pickled eggs.
Oddly, this is actually the studio track and not a live performance, even though a live version of Young Lust was recorded and can be heard during the end credits. Steven Tyler's drawn character also appears in some Simpsons comics as well. Lizzie McGuire. In 2002, Steven Tyler played Santa Claus on the episode Extreme Christmas. The episode features the closest thing we'll ever get to an Aerosmith Christmas song, with Tyler performing Santa Claus is Coming to Town. The appearance actually stemmed from his daughter Chelsea and him watching the show in 2002, and Tyler reaching out to producer.
You must be asking yourselves, how could we possibly get Steven Tyler to be on Lizzie McGuire?
I'm sitting there watching it and said, Chelsea, what is this show? What is this? She goes, oh, it's Lizzie McGuire. Don't you know anything, Daddy? No, I've been to Maine, Spain, and Spokane, but I had not seen this Lizzie McGuire show, so we watched it and I fell in love with the character, and the rest is history. Now I'm on the set, my kids are in it.
You're too skinny to be Santa.
Well, you may be too skinny, but you sure look old enough.
Hey.
That's it. Go watch it. Steven Tyler was a judge on American Idol.
Hi. L.A., here we come. You allowed to show this on film? Probably not. Well, here we go. You didn't really think I was going to come out without one, did you?
In 2010, Steven Tyler would replace Simon Cowell as a judge for the 10th season of American Idol alongside Randy Jackson and fellow new judge Jennifer Lopez. He was a judge for two seasons, in which the first year he did a solo performance of Dream On, and then the next year they came back as a full band and did their new song Legendary Child. This almost caused Tyler to be replaced from Aerosmith, as he was devoting more time away from the band. He didn't even tell his other bandmates, as Joe Perry remarked, I found it on the internet, like the rest of the world. However, in 2012, Tyler announced that he would be leaving, saying, after some long, hard thoughts, I decided that it's time for me to let go of my mistress, American Idol, before she boils my rabbit. I strayed from my first love, Aerosmith, and I'm back, but instead of begging on my hands and knees, I've got two fists in the air, and I'm kicking the door open with my band. The next few years are going to be dedicated to kicking some serious ass, the ultimate auditory takeover. Tyler was replaced by Keith Urban in 2013. Polar Express. Tyler appeared in the 2004 film as the chief elf and singing Rocking on Top of the World as it appears on the soundtrack.
Apparently, some kid from Maplewood, New Jersey stuck some gum in his sister's hair.
No, sir. This kid's name is Steven.
Apparently, some kid from Maplewood, New Jersey stuck some gum in his sister's hair.
No, sir. This kid's name is Steven.
And also, the fucking elf is really scary. Like, what the fuck? What is that? Why did you do this? Everything else is so pretty in this movie. Drake and Josh. Why did I say it again? For the majority of the show, in the boys' room, there was a poster for Just Push Play that was released in 2001. Nine Lives cover. A major controversy followed Aerosmith after they released the 1997 album Nine Lives. The original cover featured a cat woman dancing on the heads of cobra snakes. However, it wasn't exactly this cut and dry. The snake the woman was dancing on was actually the snake demon
Kalia,
and the woman herself was Lord Krishna, two figures deeply important to the religion of Hinduism. The band themselves have no idea about the cover, and following the backlash, Columbia apologized, and the album was re-released with a different cover.
The album wasn't released without a hitch, though. Not unlike the controversial pierced cow udder on the Get a Grip cover, which riled some animal rights groups, there was religious objection to the artwork on Nine Lives.
We turned it over to this guy who's an artist in New York, a commercial artist, and said, come up with some ideas. So we found this picture, apparently in some copywritten Hare Krishna book, brought it to us and said it was original art. So the next thing is we print up about 4 million of these, and the night before it's going to get shipped all over the world, we get a call from the Hare Krishna's lawyer who says, we're deeply offended by this. This is horrible. This can't go on. So we, for an ungodly amount of money, we licensed it from them.
And then come along the Hindus and say that they were unhappy with it because we were defacing the image of their god by virtue of putting a cat's head on it.
At that point, we'd had so much bullshit around this, that we just said, you know, we don't want to hurt anybody's feelings unless we mean to.
That's why we're going to change it. If we're going to offend somebody, we don't want to do it by accident.
However, this wasn't actually the end of controversies with the CD, as the CD itself had drawn depictions of sexual positions, and Walmart themselves refused to sell the CD in their stores. It has since been changed. Aero Force One, Blue Army. These are the names of the then and now Aerosmith fan base. First coined in 1975, the name Blue Army comes from the appearance of many concertgoers being working-class men and women in denim pants and jackets. Founding member Ray Tabano actually had the idea to run the fanbase after t-shirts of the band's logo sold out at a concert. The fan club was run out of the band's warehouse in Walton, Massachusetts. Sometime in the 1980s, the name was changed to Aero Force One in reference to Air Force One, the presidential airplane. You can actually still get access to the fan club as of this video, and the perks include like 10% off merch, early access to concert tickets, a pin, and a t-shirt. You also could get on a forum, a fan forum, a really good fan forum actually, and I remember being on it, and people would discuss like different albums and stuff like that. It was actually a lot of fun. You can't get on it anymore. It's been discontinued since like 2016. There is a new one. I think it's Aerosmith Force or Aero Force 2 or Aero Force 1.2.com. I'm not sure. I'll have to find it. But yeah. So a lot of rumors, a lot of stuff that surrounds the band will be coming from those forums. So those Aero Force 1 forums from like 2001, keep those in mind. Tour problems. Throughout 5 decades of touring, many problems are sure to happen, and Aerosmith is no stranger to them. In 1979, Joe Perry left the band during the Right in the Nuts tour, stopping the tour for 3 months while a replacement could be found. In 1981, Steven Tyler was involved in a motorcycle crash that ended the same tour. While he recovered, the band was unable to tour for that entire year as well. In 1993, Aerosmith fired one of their opening acts, Megadeth, after Dave Mustaine spoke poorly of Aerosmith, saying, "Yeah, we think we ought to be headlining, but we don't mind because everybody knows this is Aerosmith's last hurrah."
And the Grammy goes to...
It's Living on the Edge.
Aerosmith.
You'd be surprised how expensive it costs to look this cheap.
And the winner is... Aerosmith. And the winner is Aerosmith crying.
The winner is
Aerosmith crying.
There was a time when some would have said we're over, but yeah, we came back just to kick some ass.
In 1997, 43 tour dates had to be straight up canceled, and 36 dates had to be rescheduled due to Steven breaking his leg and Joey Crane recovering from second-degree burns and freak accident at a gas station. Several dates in 2001 had to be canceled or rescheduled due to the main event that happened in 2001, and I do not want to get this demonetized, so we're just going to say something really bad happened in 2001. Moving on. In 2006, Tom Hamilton had set out a couple of shows while undergoing treatment for throat cancer. Tyler also pulled out of a tour in 2009 to focus on solo projects. Many dates in 2020 were also canceled due to the pandemic. In 2022, Tyler re-entered rehab after a relapse and had to cancel their early 2022 Vegas residency shows. Tour injuries. Like tour problems, the band has had many injuries on their tours as well, such as Tyler and band members passing out from drugs in the 1970s and early 80s. Tyler also injured his feet many times on tours in the early days. Tyler also mentioned his leg on the 1997 tour, as I mentioned before, and needed throat surgery in 2006. Brad Whitford also had to set out of some shows in 2009 due to a head injury. Hits. Just to cover my tracks, here's every single hit song Aerosmith has had in order. Dream On, Same Old Song and Dance, Train Kept a Rollin', Sweet Emotion, Walk This Way, Toys in the Attic, Last Child, Back in the Saddle, Draw the Line, Come Together, Remember Walking in the Sand, Let the Music Do the Talking, Dude Looks Like a Lady, Angel, Ragdoll, Love in an Elevator, Janie's Got a Gun, What It Takes, Other Side, Living on the Edge, Eat the Rich, Crying, Amazing, Shut Up and Dance, Deuces Are Wild, Crazy, Falling in Love is Hard on the Knees, Pulling My Soul, Pink, I Don't Want to Miss a Thing, Jaded, Girls of Summer, Baby Please Don't Go, and Devil's Got a New Disguise. There are more here and there, but these are mainly the songs that get played on tour as of 2019. The others are heavy fan favorites. Alicia Silverstone. In 1993, this up-and-coming actress started many Aerosmith videos, these being Crazy, Crying, and Amazing. These performances would catch the eye of Amy Heckerling, who thought she would be perfect in her upcoming movie. This movie ended up being Clueless, a massive hit in 1995. She has gone on to win countless awards for her acting roles, but also does some kind of weird things with her kids. So, cool that you were in some Aerosmith videos, but kind of weird that you fed your kid food that you chewed up yourself. And I'm not kidding, she really did that. Go look that up. Home releases. Aerosmith has done plenty of home releases with live shows, music videos, and a homemade documentary. These range from VHS to Laserdisc to DVD. The earliest being Video Scrapbook in 1987, featuring music videos as well as bits of a live performance at the Pontiac Silverdome in 1976. And a good size of these releases from this era remain on VHS and Laserdisc and have yet to see a re-release on DVD or Blu-ray.
Below the Waves. Unplugged, Unreleased.
In 1990, Aerosmith became one of the first artists to perform on MTV's Unplugged. The show was filmed and broadcast, but unlike other artists after them, the recording of the show remains unreleased officially. There is no good reason given to why that is, so here's hoping it's officially released. Meanwhile, if you feel a little dangerous, you can go and find a bootleg of the show. It is out there, and it's actually pretty good. But I'm not saying you go out and download something illegally.
B-sides.
There are plenty of goodies hidden on Aerosmith albums. As early as 1978's Live Bootleg, the performance of Draw the Line at Ontario Speedway in 1977 is hidden after Mother Popcorn. This was intentional due to the band wanting to keep an authentic bootleg experience. There is also a track that plays after What It Takes on Pump, performed by Randy Rain Roche. On the Pandora box set, on CD3, there is a hidden track that plays. This is an outtake from the Draw the Line session called Circle Jerk. Finally, on Just Push Play, there is a reprise of the song Under My Skin that plays after Avant Garden, or Face if you have the international version. Before I continue, I'd like to say that I'm only including B-side songs that weren't on any studio album or a remix of the song itself, though the latter should deserve its own topic, or video. On the B-side of Dude Looks Like a Lady, you can hear a country rock song, Once Is Enough. On the other side, B-side, you can find Aerosmith's live performance of the Wayne's World theme on SNL. On the Living on the Edge B-side, there is Don't Stop and Can't Stop Messing, only on the US version. On Blind Man, there is a song called Head First. On Falling in Love is Hard on the Knees, there is the song Fall Together. On Hole of My Soul, there is the song Falling Off. Now, Fall Together and Falling Off were released officially on the international versions of the album, but I'm only going by the US versions themselves, as these records are kind of harder to find. To close out where to find extra tracks, we have the international versions of albums. Japan's Pump release has a track called Ain't Enough. Get a Grip has the song Can't Stop Messing on its UK release. On the Japan version of Nine Lives, there's Falling Off and Fall Together, like I mentioned before, and the Japan version of Just Push Play has Face and Won't Let You Down. Music from Another Dimension has I'm Not Talking and Shaky Ground, not as an international version, but actually as a Walmart exclusive. There are a few other Walmart exclusive style albums out there, but they're kind of redundant and I'm not going to go really in depth with them.
Making of Pump.
In 1990, Aerosmith released a documentary of the production of Pump, from the initial songwriting ideas to its final mixing. It's an interesting look into what the band went through, with real interactions of the band as well as ongoing interviews with band members. It was a direct-to-home movie, available on DVD, VHS, and believe it or not, Laserdisc. It is also available on YouTube, with all the actual music videos intact.
Good.
labels. In 1972, Aerosmith was signed to Columbia Records by Clive Davis. In 1987, Aerosmith left Columbia to join Geffen Records. In 1997, they went back to Columbia, and in 2009, Aerosmith began to release records under the Sony UMG label. However, some of their albums still say Columbia. This is due to the fact that Sony bought Columbia in 1988, but still releases some albums under the Columbia banner.
Richie Supa.
In 1978, on the album Live Bootleg, the song Chip Away appears as a live version performed in Santa Monica on April 8, 1978. This is widely renowned as one of the band's best hidden gem songs. However, what a lot of folks know, the song actually wasn't written by the Tyler Perry duo or by Brad, Tom, or Joey. It was actually written by longtime friend of the band Richie Supa, who brought it to the band in 1976. This is the first time the band would use a song from an outside songwriter, something they would become more familiar with in the late 80s and beyond. Supa would try to write songs for the band again for Get a Grip and Nine Lives, but these still remain as outtakes, and we'll get to those later. NASCAR. In 2006, Aerosmith did a full revision of their song Back in the Saddle, changing the lyrics to better relate to NASCAR. The song and video that was filmed in Las Vegas was used to open up NASCAR coverage on ESPN and ABC that year. It's on YouTube as well. You should go watch it. It's actually pretty good. It's not as bad as the Patriots theme that we're going to get into later. Anthem troubles. Steven Tyler had a few controversies over performances of the national anthem, including the 2001 Indy 500. Tyler changed the line Home of the Brave to Home of the Indianapolis 500. An upset fan told Associated Press, "It would have been nice if it had been about us, because it's Memorial Day weekend." Tyler was later quoted, "I've gotten in trouble my whole life for having a big mouth." Tyler said in his statement following the backlash, "I'm very proud to be an American and live in the home of the brave." In 2012, Tyler also got into hot water during the New England Patriots-Baltimore Ravens game after slightly forgetting the lyrics. These two are also available on YouTube. Patriots. In 2012, under partnership with Pepsi, Aerosmith released an updated version of their recently released Legendary Child, featuring lyrics related to the New England Patriots. It's not very good. First tour bus. Aerosmith's first tour bus was a 1964 International Harvester Metro van owned by Mark Lehman. Mark would take care of the band while also taking control of the driving duties, setting up gear, and running sound for the band in the very early 70s. He's also the man painted on the side as well. Aerosmith had a falling out with Lehman, and he took the van and parked it until 2019 when American Pickers found the van, restored it, and then sold it back to Aerosmith to be used during their Las Vegas residency. As of 2022, the band hopes to have the band put into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland, Ohio. Rock and Roast and Coffee. In 2015, Joey Kramer started his own line of coffee beans called Rock and Roast and Coffee. Flavors included Sumatra Dark Roast, Ethiopia Dark Roast, Espresso Dark Roast, and Guatemala Medium Roast. The coffee was available in whole bean, perfectly ground, and 12-pack S&S cups. The website is still up today, and you can still purchase coffee to have mailed to you, as well as some select stores still carrying the coffee. There was also a coffee shop in Little Attleboro, Massachusetts, as well as a ski resort in Maine. The coffee shops closed abruptly in 2017, a little over a year after opening. As of 2022, the Massachusetts location still remains intact with its same theme, but the location is entirely vacant. I actually have pictures. I went there. Rock Your World. In 2002, Joe Perry launched his own hot sauce, Rock Your World. Fed up with the quality of food on tour, Perry wanted the sauce they could use to liven up the bland flavors of food given to them. Traveling on the road, you run into a lot of bland food. So I got into carrying around my own hot sauce. Then I was having trouble finding something I really liked that was the perfect one. Either it was too hot, or too fruity, or too much vinegar, or too much tomato. So I ended up coming up with a formula. The taste is described as a mild, but not too spicy sauce, perfect for everyday use. Later, Perry would add three different flavors, Mango Peach Tango, a fruity tangy sauce, Boneyard Brew, a chipotle flavored sauce, as well as a barbecue sauce. There were also plans for a rockin'roni macaroni and cheese, but it was never released. Unfortunately, as of 2015, the sauces were discontinued. Mama Kins.
Welcome to our home away from home. There is no place like home sweet home. It's better far than riches. Cause when you're in your own sweet home, you can scratch any place that itches.
Opened in 1994, Mama Kins Club was an Aerosmith themed club that the band partially owned. The club was a regular spot for local music, as it was a better chance to get noticed.
Knowing how hard it is for a band to play in any place that's halfway decent, that actually looks out for local talent, so to speak, we always wanted to give something back to the town we came from. What don't kill you only makes you stronger, see? So we decided to have a club and give back to the new and upcoming bands what we got ourselves, one step better.
You know, we wanted to put a good sound system in there, a recording studio in the basement, and those things pretty much lived up to that.
One of the things we wanted to do is make sure the sound system was great, you know, because that's one of the things when you're playing in clubs, the sound always sucks. So, you know, that's one of the most important things for us was to make sure the sound's good, and it sounded good.
4,000 screaming watts of sound, which will raise or lower your socks at any given moment.
The band also gave ability for unsigned bands to use the in-house recording software, audio and video, to be used to present to record companies. The band also played a few shows at the hall, particularly the final show on the Get a Grip tour. This show was broadcast over FM across the US. I highly recommend tracking down this performance, as the band played an excellent show that night. The band also did a private show here in 1995, but we'll get to that later. In 1999, the band stepped away from the venue, selling their half of the ownership back to Loins. The band found it tough to manage the club while not being in the area due to touring. The site is now a part of the House of Blues as of 2022.
Mama Kin was the first song I wrote, put what I knew on the piano into the guitar, and I came up with Mama Kin, so we took that title and named the club that. And so there it sits with a big microphone out in front, and people come from all over the world, you know, to try our brew of the month, you know, some of the Aerosmith famous sanctified mead.
Flash. It's a pretty well-known fact that Slash of Guns N' Roses was heavily influenced by Aerosmith in the late 70s. Slash recalls, when he first heard Rocks, I was chasing a girl who was twice my age. When I finally got into her apartment, she played me Rocks for the first time, and that record transformed my life. It felt like it was almost written for me. Once I heard that, all of a sudden I understood what life was all about. I remember hearing Walk This Way on the radio. I vaguely remember liking the song, but I wasn't aware who Aerosmith were. Then the Rocks album turned me upside down. I got a hold of that. This was at a time when I didn't have any money at all, so to buy a whole record was a big thing. Another album he holds high regards for is Live Bootleg, saying it's the greatest live album of all time. Slash also owned the Toxic Twin t-shirt that he got from the band, and later on, Slash would own a very familiar 1959 Gibson Les Paul. After Joe Perry left Aerosmith in 1980, Joe found himself having a hard time getting cash. Perry at the time had in his possession a 1959 Gibson with a tobacco sunburst finish. Around Christmas of 1980, Joe Perry sold the guitar for its rarity and value. His guitar appeared in the gatefold of Live Bootleg, and Slash fell in love with the guitar. The guitar at that time was owned by Eric Johnson, who tried to sell it back to Perry, but he couldn't afford it at the time. However, Slash got in contact with Johnson, who sold it to him. When Perry was able to afford again, it had gone missing, until Brad Whitford showed Joe Perry an issue of Guitar World with Slash posed with a Les Paul. Slash at first did not want to sell the guitar, which Perry understood. Finally, at Joe Perry's 50th birthday party, he was re-gifted the guitar. The guitar is still with Perry to this day. Rolling Clove. Very early on, while Aerosmith was gaining a following and a foothold in the American music scene, there was constant criticism laid towards Steven and Joe Perry. This being that they looked and performed closely to the Rolling Stones.
The few critics who were paying attention compared the band to their rock idols, and they didn't mean it as a compliment.
Aerosmith was compared to the Rolling Stones, and not favorably. Steven looked a little bit like Mick. Joe looked a little bit like Keith Richards.
That's the God-given body and face they have. What are they supposed to do about it, you know? So it was just one of those things that, you know, the writers could latch on to and kick this around for a long time.
The cheap imitation of Rolling Stones criticism was a constant, Tyler told Rolling Stone, and it hurt for the first couple of years. It was constantly Mick Jagger this and Mick Jagger that, and that I copied him, and Janis Joplin too. Mick was the cheapest, easiest shot. Tyler and Jagger would eventually become close friends, and they still are to this day. Mick Jagger even starred as a parody of Tyler on SNL in 2012. Toxic Twins.
Hi, this is Kenny Rogers, and this is Norman Mailer. We're the Toxic Twins from Boston's own hard rock, Aerosmith. And you're on Eye of the Storm.
This is the nickname given to both Steven Tyler and Joe Perry due to their rampant drug use in the 1970s.
We have coke, we have weed, we have all that you need. Do the backstage boogie with the Toxic Twins of Aerosmith. Come on, get OD'd with us.
The duo even had shirts printed in the 80s featuring a Toxic Twins world tour with the logo of the skull and crossbones on the front. It even had various rehab centers that the band had been to on the back.
What a fucking ham.
Hi, this is Steven Tyler of Aerosmith, and it must be snowing.
Fuck you. I'm gonna kill you.
Happy birthday and Merry Christmas.
Slash actually owned one of these t-shirts, and in the same picture that had him with the 1959 Les Paul, he's also wearing the Toxic Twins t-shirt.
Hi, this is Steven Tyler.
And I'm Joe Perry.
We'll talk. Shut up after that, God damn it! Ready? Rolling. Two. Hi, this is Steven Tyler.
And I'm Joe Perry, one of the Toxic Twins.
One more time.
I'll say Toxic Twins.
No, I want to say it. I came up with it. Hi, I'm Steven Tyler.
And I'm Joe Perry.
And we're the Toxic Twins.
And you're watching V66. Let's get this right.
Hi, I'm Steven Tyler.
And I'm Joe Perry.
The Toxic Twins of Aerosmith. And you're watching
V66. Boston Rock Video and Stereo. What are you saying back in the cell?
Nah.
Vince Neil. According to songwriter Desmond Child, Tyler came up with the idea of the song Dude Looks Like a Lady while at a bar and mistaking Motley Crue's lead singer Vince Neil as a woman with long blonde hair. Many have also labeled the song as transphobic, however Child refutes these claims as describing the song as accepting because of the lyric "Never judge a book by its cover or who you're going to love by your lover." And I'm going to leave it right at that. Quest for Fame. In 1995, Virtual Music released a PC game titled Quest for Fame. In this game, you play as a young musician who dreams to become a rock star, much like Aerosmith. The gameplay is similar to Guitar Hero, where you use a plastic guitar and a V-pick to play along with Aerosmith tunes. It also had an online service that was continued as late as 2003.
Wonder what it would be like to live the life of a rock star and experience the thrill of performance? Well, now you can. It's called the virtual guitar, and anyone can play it without a single music lesson or practice session. The fast-moving and unpredictable game includes a cast of video and hand-drawn animated characters and delivers more than 100 hours of play. You get to make the decisions, and you never know what'll be next.
This guy needs work. We're just wasting our time. Huh?
Eventually, you get to work your way to playing center stage in front of 100,000 screaming fans with America's number one rock and roll band, Aerosmith.
This morning, on the wrong side of the bed, and how I got to thinking about all those things you say.
1325 Commonwealth Avenue. This is the apartment that Aerosmith would stay in the very early days of the band. The band lived together, rehearsed, and watched Three Stooges in this exact apartment. There is a plaque marking the location and is also a private residence, so please do not try to go in there. Tom's throat cancer. In August of 2006, Tom Hamilton announced that he was diagnosed with throat and tongue cancer and had completed a 7-week course of radiation and chemotherapy. This caused him to miss some tour dates in 2006 until that December when he announced that he was cancer-free. Cancer returned in 2011, but he is now cancer-free again. This affected his speaking voice, but has not stopped him at all, even taking on lead vocals on the track Up on the Mountain on Music from Another Dimension.
It's a full circle album. The band had a progression of albums in the 70s leading up to the album Rocks, where everyone got better, and our style got more and more
boiled down to its essence.
Well, I really wanted to, you know, pay more attention to the songs that weren't necessarily designed to be on the radio or to be product. You know, the songs that, you know, that were close to how we originally started. So I guess that feeling was in there, yeah, about doing
it. I think about those better days. I didn't know these evil ways. Love and hate and jealousy came in.
Show opening tunes. Throughout the years, Aerosmith has walked on the stage with many different themes. In the 1970s, they walked out to Toccata and Fugue in D minor. In the very early 80s, they walked out to the Psycho theme. And in 1987, they walked out to a synth-style track, which still remains unnamed. For the Pump Tour in 1989 and 1990, they used a strange warbling sound, similar to a helicopter. For the Get a Grip Tour, they used a drum track similar to the one used in the song Intro, as well as a clip from The Wizard of Oz.
Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain!
For the 9 Lives Tour, they used a Middle Eastern-inspired track that fit with the album's theming. From 2001 to 2003, Aerosmith used the dial tone from Beyond Beautiful to open shows.
Hang up the phone!
In 2003, they began using the Promised Land from Monty Python. In 2004, they used R.L. Burnside's Let My Baby Ride. And after 2006, the band began to use stylized video intros and stopped using just singular songs, though they do have songs that they walk out to, being mainly just Manish Boy. The only other time they've ever walked on the stage to a singular song and not a video was at Whiskey A Go-Go in 2014, when they oddly walked out to Get Low. Future Villain Band. In 1978, Aerosmith was cast in a film adapted from a Broadway play based on the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. They play as the villainous FBB and perform Come Together in the final act of the movie. The Future Villain Band was described as an evil force that would poison young minds, pollute the environment, and subvert the democratic process. They perform in militaristic uniforms on a high platform stage that looks like stacks of money, accompanied by uniformed youth twirling flags. The movie is absolute cheese, but it's totally worth it to watch a very young Aerosmith still flaunting their stuff before drugs would start to take over a year later.
Oh.
Fenway 2022. Okay, this one's a little bit more personal to me, but I figured I'd add this one on here because I felt more widespread. During the 2022 Fenway show, my ticket, as well as many other fans' tickets, turned out to be fake, void, or just flat out unusable when bought from StubHub. To explain quickly just how StubHub works, just so that people don't think it's their fault, they run a ticket reselling marketplace where people can sell tickets that they no longer can get to, or that they no longer can get to the venue, or dates change or something like that. And my original ticket holders moved their reservation, but still sold the void ticket stub. A very nice family who sat next to me told me that they had spent $700 on tickets, only to find that they had all been refunded and sold before they had bought those tickets. I absolutely do not fully blame StubHub, however, as with the date getting pushed back twice from 2020 to 2021, and with Fenway honoring all tickets from both dates, they were just doomed to have issues. StubHub did provide me with a full refund and were extremely pleasant to work with, so it wasn't their fault, it was just that seller.
Black Crowes.
In 1990, the band Black Crowes were signed to open for Aerosmith for a few days in the summer leg of the Pump Tour. However, they would not be able to play all of these shows as their onstage antics and unprofessionalism would get them fired.
Then we get to the first gig, and of course, the most career-oriented minded group in the history of music, we open the show with a new song we've just written or something. If I remember correctly, I was crawling around on the stage with a big knife, stabbing it into the stage. I don't know what we were doing. The drummer for Aerosmith watched the opening of our set and immediately went back and contacted their management and had us fired.
Later on, the Black Crowes would say, "If you're an entertainer and take it seriously, you entertain with your natural abilities," alluding to how the band would use samples during their shows. These samples were extra snippets of vocals that Tyler could not perform while simultaneously singing the verse or chorus. This, however, led to the belief that Tyler lip syncs his shows, which is flat out false. The two bands patched things up later on and still remain friends.
The first one being, when Permanent Vacation, that tour came around, you guys went with the Black Crowes. I was wondering if you enjoyed that and whether or not you'd ever consider touring with them again.
Steven, you want to take that?
Yeah, I love the Black Crowes. Yeah, I think they're great. And we would tour with them again, yeah, sure.
Right. The best thing about them is Chris says such nice things about us.
Tongue planted firmly in cheek, Tom has. Tom, get that.
No, they're great, man.
We love Chris and the Crowes.
Great.
It's the kind of music they play, you know. It's free.
Mm-hmm.
It rocks.
Great rock and roll, much like you guys.
Yeah.
John, you had another one?
Those two.
All right, John.
All right, thanks.
Thank you, bud. Detroit, Michigan.
Steven Tyler was almost replaced. In 2009, Steven Tyler pulled out of a planned South American tour at the end of the year and seemed intent on pursuing a solo project, including his autobiography. In November of that year, Joe Perry stated that Tyler had not been in contact with the band and could be on the verge of quitting Aerosmith. Perry stated the rest of the group was looking for a new singer to work with. These include Lenny Kravitz, Sammy Hagar, Paul Rodgers, and the late Chris Cornell. The closest being Sammy Hagar, who was tempted to try out for the gig. However, he decided to reject the opportunity as he didn't want to be the replacement guy, alluding to the fact that he had already replaced David Lee Roth and Van Halen. I woke on a beach and said, "You know what? I can't do this." So that's it. In November 2009, Tyler joined the Joe Perry Project on stage to play Walk This Way and confirm that he was not leaving Aerosmith.
I want you to know I'm not leaving Aerosmith. Joe Perry, you are a man of many colors, but I, motherfucker, am the rainbow.
December, it was reported that Tyler had to re-enter rehab to manage his addiction to painkillers, brought on by injuries set to his knees, legs, and feet. On January 20th, 2010, Perry confirmed that the rest of the band were about to audition a new singer to replace Tyler. Perry said Tyler's injuries to his legs would take him out of the picture, while the rest of the band wanted to continue performing. In response, Tyler's attorney sent the band and its manager a cease and desist letter and threatened further legal action if the band did not discontinue this effort to replace Tyler. In February, the full band performed at Donningham in the UK, and the lineup has stayed the same since. Same old song, two versions. On the Get Your Wings album, Same Old Song and Dance has a lyric.
Got you whipped cocaine, I found with yoga. No smooth face, a lawyer could get you under.
This lyric was changed for radio play to
shake and look and loser, you played with my gun. No smooth face, a lawyer could get you under.
You can hear the alternative version on Greatest Hits. Sweet Emotion. Also on the Greatest Hits version, Sweet Emotion has a different song as well, with the intro bass line cut as well as the outro solo. First gig. Aerosmith's first gig was in Nipmuc High School in Mendon, Mass. Joe Perry's mother helped out with the gig along with a social studies teacher. The teacher recalled, most dances were record hops. Having live bands was kind of an unusual thing to do. A group of students convinced me to hire the group. Joe Perry was from nearby Hopedale, and the kids were real friendly with him. So we convinced the principal to allow us to take $50 out of the class treasury in order to pay them for that night. Joe Perry recalled, we had an argument over the volume of my amp. I'm still trying to find my voice on my guitar, and the band was still trying to find its sound. I think the source of the argument was deeper than my amp's volume level, and had more to do with Steven's insecurity and perfectionism. He was convinced that the audience could hear every mistake. I think it's perfectly human to make a mistake, and I care more about overall energy. Aerosmith had a habit of firing opening. Okay, this isn't actually entirely true. Aerosmith has only fired slash feuded with four opening acts in the band's history. The band Kansas recalled a story where Steven Tyler pulled the cords out of a sound rig during their set in 1974. There's also how they fired Dawkins. Many fans thought it was due to Steven Tyler being insecure, when in actuality, it seems more likely that Dawkins was still on drugs at the time and the band were worried that it could corrupt them. Don Dawkins said, we were still terrorizing still. We were kind of in a terrorizing mood. Aerosmith, that was their first sober tour. We weren't really allowed to hang out with them in case we corrupt them. Aerosmith went on to fire the Black Crowes in 1990, as mentioned before, and finally fired Megadeth after Dave Mustaine went on talk radio to claim that they should be the headliner and Aerosmith was in their last hurrah. In a bit of bias and excuse-making, the 70s were a highly competitive landscape for many bands, so this behavior wasn't totally uncommon. Not justified, but not solely an Aerosmith habit.
Middle of the Iceberg. I Don't Want to Miss a Thing video. Did you notice that Steven Tyler doesn't dance, let alone move, from his spot in the Don't Want to Miss a Thing video? On April 29, 1998, during an encore performance at the Sullivan Arena in Anchorage, Alaska, Steven Tyler injured his knee and required surgery. In May, he received surgery but had to wear a cast for weeks, during which the video was filmed.
Between his surgery and an expected 12 weeks of physical therapy, the band has already postponed a month's worth of tour dates through early June. Here's what Tyler had to say about the injury on the set of the band's latest video last Saturday.
So I was doing a song called Mama Kin, and I smacked my kneecap with my microphone bass, and I broke the anterior cruciate ligament. And so I'm looking at Brad and I'm going, and they got ambulance, and I came off stage, and they brought me in. They got x-rays and all that, you know, as any fine thoroughbred would have done. And they said that, you know, you're going to have to either have an operation and have to stay off it for a month and just take care of it. And I just want to call my manager up, and we had to cancel a couple of shows. And I'm still in the middle of dealing with it, but and the reality is it's still hitting me in the face, you know, of, what did you do?
Stephen wore a long robe-style outfit that conveniently covered his cast and crutches he was using at the time. On June 27, 1994, as part of a week-long promotion by CompuServe, Aerosmith became the first major label band to make a song available for exclusive digital download. Head First was an outtake from Get a Grip and eventually a B-side. During that time, download speeds were so slow that it took between 60 and 90 minutes to download the track, but 10,000 CompuServe subscribers were still made the effort to get the tune. If our fans were out there driving down that information highway, then we want to be playing at the truck stop. This is the future, so let's get it going. Soy Tu Lluvia. During the 1996-9 live session, Tyler Perry and Desmond Child wrote a song called When the Rain Stops. Tyler and Perry ultimately decided not to use the song for 9 Lives, so Child took the song to other artists. In 2002, Alejandra Guzman recorded and released the song entirely in Spanish. Later, the artist Jonas in 2004 recorded his version in English. You can absolutely hear the Aerosmith influence in both songs. It sounds similar to a sequel to Crazy, in my opinion. 1981 injury. In the fall of 1980, Steven Tyler was injured in a motorcycle crash that left him hospitalized for 2 months and was unable to tour or record for much of 1981. First AOL chat. In 1994, Aerosmith participated in the first AOL live chat with fans, who mainly asked the band to tell dirty jokes and talk about the latest album, Get a Grip. A full transcript is available. In 1998, they also became one of the first bands to live stream a concert. On October 17th, they played a show in Homedale, New Jersey that was webcast over Cybercast. This webcast was done to promote the new album Little South of Sanity. Surprisingly, the entire show was saved and can be found on YouTube, albeit in extremely low quality. They actually had two, to be completely honest. In 1990, they appeared in Rock and Roll Comics issue 11. The comic serves as an illustrated biography of the band and had a follow-up in 1993. Also in 1993, the band was featured in issue 19 of Shadow Man, where the band fights against evil forces trying to take over the world. Outtakes. This is a big one, okay? Like, I'm going to go off the script a little bit here because I don't really have one written. But let me just begin to explain to you how many outtakes and how hard it is to find these outtakes. We're going to get more into detail about a certain figure who helped spearhead the outtakes search in the early 2000s and also kind of played a hand in how they've been very hard to find. But basically, the rundown of it is there are these things called outtakes. They are songs that don't make the cut from an album. Sometimes they're just a chorus or a verse, and they can be used in different songs, but since they're just a chorus and a verse for one song, but they get completely left in that state with an entirely different name, they're considered an outtake. Now,
there are certain times where a song can be considered an outtake for a certain album and can be released later on an album, such as the example of Major Barbara. Major Barbara was considered for a lot of albums from the very early ages to the very, very, about the mid-80s, when they finally stuck it on Classics Live. We'll get more into Major Barbara later, but I just wanted to throw that one in there as an example. Another example being Sundowner Sunrise. The song was eventually released on Devil's Got a New Disguise as a new track, but it was actually considered as early as Pump in 1989, being considered for Get a Grip, Nine Lives, and Just Push Play. However, the song never really made it that far out of it. Honestly, out of all of these, I'm going to put these all up on the screen because I'm not reading all of these. Most of them, most of the ones from the 70s, have been included on a box set or a single. Like, you can find the Subway instrumental. It was from Draw the Line that didn't make it. It was released as a B-side to Sweet Emotion. There are also a couple of songs listed on the outtakes that eventually would get picked up by different band members to take to their other bands. Notably, South Station Blues and a song called Do You Wonder Why. Now, these two songs were picked up by Joe Perry. South Station Blues being taken by Joe Perry in 1979 after he left the band and would end up on one of the solo albums later in the 80s. Do You Wonder Why was written during the Nine Lives sessions, but wasn't picked up until 2009 when Joe Perry released his next album, Have Guitar, Will Travel. There's also some evidence of albums being lost due to outtake listings existing. These come from old band photographs of their studios and the walls being plastered with song names, but since these albums never came out, and these pictures still exist in videos, it kind of leads somebody to believe that this is a lost album. We'll get to lost albums way later on, but I'm just giving you a small little explanation. I will say that the hardest ones to find, that there are bootlegs for certain albums. In fact, Rockin' a Hard Place and Permanent Vacation do have bootlegs, listing a good amount of the demos and outtakes from those albums, and most of the 70s stuff too, but after you get to Pump, pretty much everything dries up. But there are a lot of songs on these lists that only have 15 seconds available on YouTube. Not even on YouTube anymore. Some of them are completely wiped from the internet. You have to know somebody to find them. But some of them have been gone as early as 2009. Back before anybody was really backing up stuff like this. Out of the ones that I would really like to hear, I've always been looking for Black Cherry. It was a song that was completed, mixed, but it was pulled from the album at the last minute, due to the fact that they were worried that Steven would back himself into a sexual addiction again in 1993. Another song I'd really love to hear again is Meltdown. I've heard a small leaked phone call of the song being played, which we'll get into that as well. And of course, from Nine Lives, I'd love to hear the actual full version of Loretta. I've heard the snippets of it, and I think it sounds incredible. And also the song Trouble. Trouble was one of the songs actually written by Richie Supa for the band later on, but didn't get used. Now, there have been some songs that have leaked out from the 2000s, like Blue Eyes Blue, Painted on My Heart, and the early versions of Angel's Eye. There is also one last song that doesn't really have an album that it was being worked on, but it's just been mentioned by Tom Hamilton, being called Diamond Dance Romance. I have no idea any information about that song or anything really other else about the song. You'll really have, I can't play any of these songs also because it will get taken down by UMG. They are very strict about this stuff nowadays. They do not play around with you guys playing these outtakes. That's what makes some of these outtakes being found so difficult. Because nowadays, most bands can have their outtakes being posted most places, and they can be around for a couple of days. But it seems like every single Aerosmith outtake that gets put up gets taken down in 5 minutes. And honestly, I've heard rumor that really the reason why you can't find most of the stuff is because a lot of the private collectors will charge absurd amount of money to even let you hear these outtakes. Some people, you just have to know the right person. And sometimes you just luck out. There is no finding. The internet isn't what it used to be in 2005, and that's a shame because I was not really cognizant during that period of time. So I missed out on a lot of this good stuff. Maybe one day they'll actually put out this Pandora's Box 2 that they've been talking about, but, you know, we'll get into that later. There's a lot of stuff in this outtakes thing that we will get into later that I've hinted at or kind of mentioned, and honestly, this should be its own video, which I will make eventually if you guys are interested, but there's not much that I can do in ways of playing, but we really need to actually hear the real song. we're dying for another album. We're dying for another bit of this crazy giant box set. I don't care if it costs $500 and has 60 CDs. Hell, just really, just put it out on, like, just leak it yourselves. You've done it before. Just do it. Nine Last Resort.
Welcome to the last resort. The adventures we'll have. The stories we'll tell. You can't live without us.
All right, you've seen enough of the last resort for now. Don't be so cheap. Buy this game, and you won't be disappointed. Nine, over and out.
This is a very strange puzzle game from 1996 where you are tasked as the inheritor of a large hotel and must build a muse machine to banish the toxic twins played by Tyler and Perry. An interesting note, Joe Perry doesn't actually talk. However, he does use a talk box to speak as the character.
You are the interloper.
The legendary voices of Aerosmith, Steven Tyler, and Joe Perry bring the game's mischievous twins to life.
You know, we're really excited to actually see it done, you know, because it's like all these pieces, the way these games are put together, it's so in pieces, you know, like from the concept on the storyboard to seeing bits and pieces on somebody's power book and then throwing the voices in. It's always exciting to see it all put together, you know, so we're excited about that.
Leonard Skinner Plain. On October 20th, 1977, three members of Leonard Skinner would die tragically in a plane crash just outside of Gillensburg, Mississippi. The CV-240 would lazily plunge into a forest and burst into flames on impact. This is the same plane that was looked over by many of the bands, one of which being Aerosmith, who passed on the plane a few months before the crash. The safety of the plane and the seriousness of the crew were the deciding factors. One of Aerosmith's assistants recalled seeing pilots McCreary and Gray passing around a bottle of Jack Daniels back and forth while his father and he were inspecting the plane. Lotto. In 2009, Rhode Island State Lottery began offering a scratch-off lottery tickets themed to Aerosmith. The major jackpot was $100,000. Later on, New Mexico would do the same thing. There's really not much more information I have about this. It's just a scratch-off ticket. I thought it was neat.
Wouldn't you jump at the chance? Play Dream On.
Dream On, the new instant game from the Rhode Island Lottery.
Okay, this is another one that could have an hour's worth of just me jabbering on about this. So I'm going to make this one shorter and sweet because I know that I probably took 10 minutes just talking about the outtakes. I'm not going to go that hard about these bootlegs. Aerosmith, like many bands of the time, were subject to bootlegs of their live show as early as 1973. Many shows were recorded by fans in the crowd, and some were recorded from the soundboard of the band's instruments.
We'll be right back.
Bootlegs were available online through forums dedicated to the band, and with the advent of cell phones, bootlegs are becoming increasingly easier to make and find. Another type of bootleg that is highly sought after are bootlegs of demos and outtakes. Honestly, you want my suggestion? Seriously? Go find their performance at Mama Kin's in 1994, the December 19th one. That show is incredible. They had just gotten done with, I think it was a 500 show tour across 2 years, I think. I'm not positive. It might be 4. I think it was 600. Either it was 600, 400, 300, 500. It was somewhere. It was triple numbers. It was their biggest tour before the global warming tour in 2012. It's the closest feeling of a band excited for the last day of school, and they are having a. The whole set list is just old 70s tunes that they had played back like in the early club days that they're now playing in their new little home in Boston in front of their home crowd, and it's incredible. You can find it really easily on YouTube. Don't go out and download it illegally. Vindaloo Vault. This is the name of the fictitious vault in which Aerosmith keeps their demos, outtakes, live performances, other promo, and media bits. These vaults are considered a gold mine to any extreme Aerosmith fan. Logo origin. Ray Tabano designed the first Wings logo in 1974. This logo would change in 1975 to a V-shaped pattern before becoming the true Wings logo in 1978. Also, as a side note, many sites claim that they started using this in 1982. That's not true. The first time they used the actual traditional winged logo was 1978's live bootleg. It was literally on the cover. I don't know how people missed it. Jeff Lynne. Jeff Lynne, famously known for his work with ELO and the Traveling Wilburys, as well as producing songs for Tom Petty and George Harrison, produced a song with Aerosmith. In 1992, Lynne would help write the song Lizard Love for the Get a Grip album. When it wasn't included, it was reworked for the Jurassic Park soundtrack, but was rejected. Finally, in 2003, the song was released in the Rugrats Go Wild soundtrack. In 2001, Jeff Lynne told Rockline Radio.
The other part of your question, it was great fun meeting, and I just did a little bit with Aerosmith. We just tried to write a little song called Lizard Love, but it never got finished. But it was great hanging out with the guys, and they're real nice guys.
They are really nice guys and ran real pros and turned themselves around about 15 years ago.
Oh, absolutely.
They were headed down the wrong road there, but that sounds like a title for an Aerosmith song.
Steven Tyler hated music videos. During an interview with Steven Tyler, he mentioned he was bummed that he had to do the MTV. Tyler's opinion on the matter was that
it's half of this side and half of that. One side, I'm really bummed out that I have to do MTV to get my music across. I have to paint a picture that goes along with my music. Music is that the beauty is in the ear of the beholder. You know, you hear it and you think whatever's going on at that time. And that's what the song is about. Once you paint the picture and you watch that long enough, every time you hear the song, you think of the picture you saw, the imagery. And I think that sucks.
Aerosmith was almost in Wayne's World 1.
We're not worthy! We're not worthy!
You're worthy, you're worthy. Get up!
With an interview with Penelope Spheeris, I hope I pronounced that right, Aerosmith was originally intended to be in the first Wayne's World movie. However, the band turned them down, feeling the film wouldn't do as well. Unfortunately for the band, the movie was actually a really big hit, and when it came time for the sequel, the band appeared again. But this time, the bell had rung, and the sequel didn't do nearly as well. Songs not played live. Aerosmith has played a good amount of their catalog live, with most early albums getting near full plays. However, there are songs that they have not played live. These songs are Spaced on Get Your Wings, Home Tonight on Rocks, Draw the Line with Critical Mass, Cheesecake, Rockin' a Hard Place with Cry Me River, Prelude to Joni, Joni's Butterfly, Push Come to Shove, Done with Mirrors has Reason a Dog, Gypsy Boots, Permanent Vacation oddly has Only St. John, Get a Grip really oddly has Line Up, a literal song that has a bar mix not played live. I still don't understand how they didn't play that one. Nine Lives has Ain't That a Bitch, Crash, Attitude Adjustment, Falling Angels, Fall Together. Just Push Play has Trip Hoppin', Love Lies, Out of Your Head, Avant Garden, Face, Won't Let You Down. Music from Another Dimension has literally almost all of the songs not played live. I'm not going to read all of them out. There are some other B-sides that I will also include because they did play Girls of Summer live and had a whole tour based around it. And these are Don't Stop, Ain't Enough, Can't Stop Messin', Lay It Down, and Sendora Sunrise. Though that last one is actually kind of fishy because they did actually play the song live before it was released. Didn't play it in full. Now, I said before that Music from Another Dimension really didn't have it, but the album has the least amount of songs played, with 13 out of 18 songs not played live. And it's a real shame because there are some songs on that album that were really, really good and deserve to get played, like We All Fall Down and Out Go the Lights and Beautiful, but... Mysterious Major Barbara. On Classics Live 1, the final track is an outtake from the first album entitled Major Barbara. This bittersweet ballad was a favorite of the band in the very early days and featured the earliest instance of Joe Perry playing slide on a song. The song was said to be in heavy rotation in the band's early club days. The song caused the band to lose potential first manager Steve Paul, who was angered by the band when Steven and Joe sat down to play the song. It's the only song from the early days to not have a bootleg with the song on it, even though it was used so heavily. Its last known play was December 3rd, 1971 at the Academy of Music in New York. It has also appeared on only three albums, Classics Live 1, Pandora's Box, and Road Starts Here, all with entirely different versions. The song was considered for each album released in the 70s as well. In 1978, Van Halen released their debut album, which had many guitarists such as Joe Perry marveling at his playing. However, when Eddie Van Halen would go to meet Perry, he would brush him off and outright ignore Eddie. Eddie took this as a sign that Perry hated him, but in reality, it was more jealousy. Perry told Van Halen News Desk, "Eddie's playing was phenomenal. He took everything that he'd heard and put his own little stamp on it, and I thought, oh my god, this is great. There were a lot of things that he did where I was scratching my head and wondering how he did it, little tricks and things. I was blown away with what he was doing. Eddie came along like a breath of fresh air. It was fresh and hard, and it felt like it was the start of something new. It was kind of like when you first heard Nirvana or the Sex Pistols. Eddie's playing was revolutionary." The pair would eventually become good friends long before Eddie's passed in 2020. Joe Perry even mentioned the band in a 2001 interview when asked,
"When you look around now, just off the top of your head, Can you think of any bands that you look at now and you say, Jesus Christ, that's us 10 years ago. That's us 15 years ago. That's
us happens about every 6 months.
Well, give me the last one if you can think of them.
Oh, I remember a baby band called Van Halen. the list just goes on and on. So.
Slot machine. In 2017, online gaming company Hit It Rich announced that they'd be releasing an online slot game themed to Aerosmith. Now, I also can't seem to find it, but I swear I remember there was a standalone slot machine released in 2014 promoed on the band's social pages. I can't seem to find it, but I do remember it being blue, like bright blue with the logo on top. I could be getting it confused with the Back to the Future slot machine, but I swear I remember there being an Aerosmith standalone slot machine somewhere in Vegas and before their residency. Band paid fans bond in 1976. During a show on October 3rd, 1978, at the Allen County War Memorial Coliseum in Fort Wayne, Indiana, 20 18s were arrested for smoking pot and drinking alcohol. The local police tried to nab Tyler for inciting a riot when he stopped the show to call out the arrest being made. The next day, the band paid over $4,000 to pay for all the fans to be released. Brad Woodford, NASCAR fan. Brad Woodford is a self-proclaimed car nut. He once stated that he wasn't a rock star, he would like to be a race car driver, and that his favorite smell is the racetrack, burnt ethanol. Brad has also appeared at many NASCAR events, particularly when the band had their logo on Kenny Wallace's number 55 Chevrolet in 1999. It was also Brad who was the driving force behind Aerosmith doing their ESPN promo in 2007. Brad's Twitter bio also confirms, as of 2016, he is still a NASCAR fan. The Warehouse. This is the name given to Aerosmith's home base from much of the later 70s. The band's fan club would also be run at this location, as well as plenty of meet and greets, even a Halloween party in 1976. The band also had a recording studio here as well, and would use it to practice songs for the Rocks album, and would let bands rent the space for themselves as well. They moved from this location sometime in the 1980s, and it is now a fish market. The Japan Connection. Aerosmith has always had a soft spot for their Japan fans. As early as 1977, when the band was playing its first world tour, it made stops in Japan. The band has also spent a few New Years in Japan during tours. Many of the band's albums released in Japan contain extra tracks specifically because the band can't tour there as often. And in 2011, they made it a point to continue their planned tour in Japan after the tsunami. This was filmed and released as Rock for the Rising Sun. These audiences are different from anywhere else in the world, remarked Tyler. I've always found that very endearing. So to come back here now, it's, you know, a beautiful thing. Joe Perry also added, it feels like home when we're here. Proceeds from the DVD went to help folks struggling with the disaster. And also, a lot of the leaks of outtakes came from Japan. They were obsessed with them in the early 2000s, and they still are. The movie contains Scott's Gaelic. In the final track from 1987's Permanent Vacation, there is a woman who speaks in a language unfamiliar to native listeners of Aerosmith. This is Christine Arnott, and a rough translation shows that it's Scots Gaelic, and she says, I'm really unsure if this translation includes the bit spoken in the intro, and if somebody can confirm that is what they're saying, that'd be appreciated. Who is Suki Jones? Suki Jones is a fictional character mentioned in songs such as Back in the Saddle and Push Comes to Shove. It is believed she is based on a groupie from that time, but I can't find any factual information on this. And Steven Tyler says himself that she is a fictional prostitute written specifically for Back in the Saddle. Steven Tyler's real name. Steven Tyler's real name is Steven Victor Tallarico. Bottom of the Iceberg. Joni's Butterfly was supposed to be an instrumental. As stated by Jimmy Crespo in an interview, the song was meant to be a completely instrumental song, but when Steven heard it, he had to put lyrics to it. This can be heard on the bootleg, Pure Gold, which we'll get into on this level.
Well, I'm going to play this piece that I wrote for Rock and a Hard Place. It was supposed to be an instrumental.
Okay.
But Steven loved it and decided that he had to put lyrics to it. But I'm gonna play it as I wrote it originally.
Okay.
So here it goes.
Joe Perry is jealous of jailbait. In the Pandora's Box booklet, when referring to jailbait, Perry mentions that even though I wasn't around for that song, I still think it's pretty hot. I would have done it a little differently, but if anything, I'm a little jealous that I didn't get to play on it. This is one of the only songs Perry has mentioned, let alone talked about, from Rockin' a Hard Place. Ray Tabana. Ray was a founding member of Aerosmith, and after he was replaced by Brad Whitford, he went on to create the first Aerosmith logo in 1974, and the fan club in 1975. In 1982, the band's new management booted him from running the fan club, however, he still remains close friends with the band, even being called upon to verify the band's first tour bus on American Pickers.
Is it it?
It certainly looks like it. Oh, my goodness gracious.
Yeah, man.
We've found Aerosmith's van.
It's history, baby.
Raymond's boots on the ground. He's animated. He's excited. This is cool.
I'll tell you right now, I have a picture of the inside of this van with me in it.
Really?
Yes,
get
I do.
Out of here.
Yes, I do.
Really?
I have a picture of me inside this. It was in the Draw the Line book. There's a picture of me and Steven Tyler and Joey Kramer and Joe Perry inside the van from the back door. We put the band together originally in 1970. I was around till about almost 1972. And then I left the band and I moved up to Maine. I wanted to be a hippie. And then about a year later, Steven called me up. He said, we just signed our first album deal. I want you to come back to work for the band. So I came back to work for the band, not as a musician, but as one of the guys in the organization. I decided, listen, I have a good idea. Why don't we start a merchandise company? I redesigned the Aerosmith logo to the one that we use today. And I went into the merchandise business with them. And that's what I did for about 8 years. So I was with them all together until about 1979, yeah.
Songs the band hates. Steven Tyler has gone on to say that he hates Dude Looks Like a Lady and Angel. Tyler felt the songs got too much radio play after Permanent Vacation came out. The band isn't fond of Just Push Play as well. Rick Dufay. Rick Dufay is known for his work on Rockin' a Hard Place, but the story doesn't end there. He actually also played rhythm guitar on the band's last album on the song Shaky Ground, making it a 30-year gap between albums. Russ Irwin.
From Long Island on the keyboards and background vocals and making me look so good and sound so good. Russ Irwin!
A common staple of an Aerosmith show is the backing vocals being done by Russ Irwin. Irwin was the backing vocals for Aerosmith from 1997 until 2014. After touring with Aerosmith, Russ went on to focus on his solo project. The band broke up over spilled milk. After a show on July 28, 1979, Perry Hamilton, Tom's wife, and Alyssa Perry, Joe's wife, got into a heated argument and Alyssa threw a glass of milk at Terry. After the argument settled, Joe said he couldn't take it anymore, took off with Alyssa, and left the band completely. Steven Tyler also ran out after him yelling, "You're fired!" Something that he says he would have never done before, but he was so hot and angry in the moment, it just blurted out.
On the 28th of July, 1979, after a sold-out show at a Cleveland stadium, the animosity that had been building up for 9 years finally came to a head over a glass of spilled milk.
Joe Perry's wife and Tom Hamilton's wife get into this huge fight, throwing things at each other.
Somebody throws something at you, you throw something back.
I threw the milk.
It was a major fight, and Joe perpetuated that fight.
It was just the same, and somebody's wife was complaining.
I saw it as, you know, what are they even doing here? You know, he didn't see that. How can you with this entity that is bigger than any single person here?
It was like the classic straw broke the camel's back. It was just so ironic that it was something as cliche as spilled milk.
We had a meeting. He said maybe I should split. And everybody kind of nodded.
And I said, that's it. I can't do this anymore. I just can't, you know, put up with this pressure cooker.
Joe Perry got into his limo and drove off in disgust. It would be years before he saw the rest of Aerosmith again.
We blamed it on the girlfriends, and it's really not about the girlfriends. It's about the guys in the relationships, you know. It's easy to sit there and blame everybody else, but really we let stuff get out of hand.
And I couldn't believe the dream was over.
Sixth member. Like the Beatles, there is a debate if Aerosmith has an extra sixth member and who exactly it is. Russ Irwin, Tom Gimbel, Richie Supa, David Woodford, Scott Cushney, and Mark Ratiss are all names mentioned in the debate over who the sixth member could be. Russ Irwin was a backing singer for 14 years with the band.
Russ Irwin on the keyboard.
Gimbel played saxophone for the band from 1989 to 1994. Richie Supa has written countless songs for the band and even helped out playing guitar after Joe Perry left in 1979. David Woodford played saxophone for the band until 1974.
Look out! We're going to bring somebody up on stage now with us. A Mr. David Woodward. Going to blow some sax. Yeah. Watch this man.
Scott Cushney has played on piano for the band for various songs. And Mark Ratiss was the band's first backing vocalist and appeared on Live Bootleg.
We'll be right back.
go solo. Neither Joe Perry or Brad Whitford did the solos on 1974's Train Kept a Rollin'. It's actually Steve Hunter in the first half and Dick Wagner in the second half. During the song's creation, Jack Douglas walked out into the recording lobby, saw Hunter and Wagner, and asked if they could help him out on recording a song. They both got paid $700 but were not credited until 2016. Walk on down intro mumbling. To this day, no one really knows exactly what Joe Perry is mumbling at the beginning of the song Walk On Down. It's likely just a mistake left in during the mixing process, but the band has never acknowledged it. You can even try trying to get down to the vocal tracks, but even with the best software that I can find, I really can't get a good helm on it. I don't even have anything I can transcribe from it. It's just mumbling. Hidden Sweet Emotion message. In Sweet Emotion, if you isolate the vocal track and play it in reverse, you will hear the message, "Thanks, Frank." This is believed to be based on the band's ex-manager, Frank Connolly, who had just been diagnosed with cancer and sold the rights to manage the band to Steve Lever and David Krebs. Lost first TV appearance. In 1973, the band appeared on American Bandstand playing Dream On. This performance is actually lost as of writing this. The band also appeared on Midnight Special in 1974, however, those performances are available on YouTube. There is a possibility that it could be included with the box sets that American Bandstand does have available, but these are extremely expensive. Prices range from $150 to $200 for a 12-DVD box set, which I am not going to buy just for one clip. Revolution X 2. A sequel to the successful Aerosmith arcade game was considered and was planned to star Public Enemy. But after poor reception of the home releases, the game was completely scrapped. There is no information available about the game or what other material were made for the game. There are no screenshots available as well. Post-1986. After the band teamed up with Run-DMC in 1986, the band was on a comeback boost.
However, many fans are split on their opinion of the band. Many accuse the band of relying heavily on outside songwriters and that they should write their own songs. Many complain about the amount of ballads and pop tunes on later albums. Fans in this group claim Done With Mirrors was the last great Aerosmith album, despite it being a massive commercial flop. On the other hand, many fans love the new Aerosmith tunes, including the ballads new and old. Really, honestly, I'm in the latter camp. Steven pushed off stage. In August 2010, Tyler accidentally hit Joe Perry in the head with his microphone stand at a show in Glentag, New York. Suffered a minor head injury, but the show was able to continue. Later at the band's August 17th show at the Air Canada Centre in Toronto, Tyler playfully bumped Perry while both were performing the song Love in an Elevator on the catwalk. In retaliation, Perry playfully bumped Tyler back, but the bump caught Tyler off guard, and Tyler fell off stage into the audience. This was the height of a small feud between Perry and Tyler that fizzled out months later. Back in the Saddle Boots. To record the sound of a horse galloping to the song Back in the Saddle, Steven Tyler got creative and wore cowboy boots with tambourines taped to them and danced on a wooden plank. There are pictures of these boots available, and I believe they're in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
That's better, man. That other one's
bring this wood in
there? Yeah.
Here we go!
Willie Nelson duet. In 1987, Joe Perry said in an interview that Willie Nelson would appear on the next record as a duet. During production, a song called Once Is Enough was created and has Willie Nelson as a duet. Strangely enough, this song would get released without Nelson on the Japan-only Vacation Club EP in 1988. However, the duet was released in 2003 on the Essential Willie Nelson album under the name One Time Too Many. Unfortunately, the song isn't even on streaming services as of right now as well, but the song is available on YouTube.
Many years ago, down in Austin, Texas, I had a studio down there, and this next gentleman came down and brought us a song, and we recorded it. I don't know how many years, it's been way too many years since we did this, but we run into each other over in Maui, and I asked him about, what about let's doing this song again? And so, how about a nice hand for Steven Tyler?
They hand-delivered Just Push Play. In 2001, Aerosmith delivered their latest record, Just Push Play, to a Boston record store during a snowstorm. This event was recorded and can be found on YouTube.
Hurry, hurry!
get out of here. We got the whole Eastern Seaboard to do. See you later. Goodbye.
Name origin. Who came up with an Aerosmith name? Joey Kramer. Apparently he would sit in class and write band names all across his notebooks and other school material. He then got stuck on Aerosmith, writing it everywhere, and when he joined the band with Tyler, he suggested it and the name stuck. Chain Reaction. This is the band Steven Tyler was in before Aerosmith was formed. Beginning in 1964, the band was first known as the Strangers, before a conflict with another band led to a name change. First, the lineup was Don Solomon on keyboard and vocals, Peter Stahl on guitar, Alan Strohmeyer on bass, Steven Tallarico on drums and vocals, and Barry Shapiro on drums. When it became Chain Reaction in 1966, the band remained the same but changed their name slightly. Steve Talley, Peter Stahl, Alan Strohmeyer, Don Sloan, and Barry Shore. The band released four songs, two in 1966 and two more in 1968. These were The Sun, When I Needed You, Should Have Been Here Yesterday, and Ever Loving You. Steven does lead vocals on three songs, backing on You Should Have Been Here Yesterday. When I Needed You appeared on the Pandora's Box, but it's in its cover. The rest of the songs exist on YouTube and can be heard there. My particular favorite is The Sun. Still casting, even in the pre-Aerosmith days, Steven had a knack for harmonica.
Through his teens, Steven experimented with an ever-changing lineup of bands. By 1966, the 18-year-old was fronting Chain Reaction, a group that would release two singles on CBS Records.
I was crazed. I wanted to play rock and roll. It was whatever it takes, you know. Fake it till you make it, right? Pretend to be somebody until that somebody turns into you.
In the summer of 1966, Steven started playing gigs at The Barn, a popular music venue near his family's holiday retreat in Lake Sunapee, New Hampshire. He became a local hero to kids like Joe Perry and Tom Hamilton. So I'm telling you, baby, I'm the
best I can. Anytime when Steven was coming up with his band, everybody was like, wow, it was a big event. For the first couple of years, Joe and I couldn't even go in because we were too young to get in the barn, so we would sit outside and listen.
Steven had recorded songs, you know what I mean, and had a song on the jukebox. So we really, you know, looked up to him.
I'd like to say, looking back on Pandora's Box, is there something that you wish you would have put on it that was omitted, or are you very happy that it is what it is, and everything that should have been in it is?
That's the kitchen sink album.
Really?
Put everything on there there was. Are you kidding?
The only thing that's not on there is The Sun. There's a reason for that, too.
That's right. That's not on there. And I'm sorry about that. Me it too. Be I regret on there. That.
You
I'm
the ball,
bummed,
Joe.
Man.
You dropped the
it
ball.
It comes once a day.
No, that gets from hither to yon, man. That song is, I mean, that album is.
Tell
just,
them what that was.
That's the very first song I ever sang anything on. It was back in... Well, never
Don't
mind.
Don't say it.
That'll be on Pandora's Box,
That's
too.
Right.
Thank you, Christopher.
Pandora's Socks.
Not if Steven can Pandora's help.
Socks. Your Gold Point 999, Permanent Outtake. These are two of the best and easiest to find outtake bootlegs. Pure Gold is comprised of demos and outtakes from Rock and a Hard Place, and Permanent Outtake comprises Permanent Vacation demos and outtakes. These two are extremely easy to find, but I really stress in avoiding the sister bootleg, Permanent Vacation outtakes, the 3-CD set, as these are recorded in mono and are not up to the same quality as Permanent Outtakes. And plus, a lot of them are just repeats with just different names written. It's not a bootleg worth searching for. Right in the Nuts. The album Night in the Ruts is a spoonerism of Right in the Nuts, and the following tour reflects that. Steven had a habit of writing out phrases like this, and the band was trying to name an album this as early as 1974.
Enough of our last album. We're going to start off our next album, which should be out in December. It's called Night in the Ruts. It's a little song called Son of Shit. That's right, that's very good. Yes. We'd like to do some boogie off our new album entitled Night in the Ruts. Ooh.
Rockin' the Joint DVD. Only made available from Best Buy, this copy of Rockin' the Joint in 2007 also came with a DVD of select songs from the album and video performance. The CD is not too hard to find, but it's almost completely forgotten in the collector's circle. On the 9 Live CD, there is a PC game that preloads onto your computer. It's similar to Quest of Fame, but has new songs from 9 Live that you can play on the game's guitar or drums with help of the keyboard and still supports the D-pad. Unfortunately, the PC game will not preload on any PCs past Windows XP. Tail End. One of the mysteries surrounding various outtakes is a track called Tail End. For many years, fans didn't know what this track was or what it could have been. In reality, it was actually already on 9 Live. The song Crash has an extended drum outro that Tyler said he wrote after dragging in metal trash cans and sewing Joey Kramer, a drum piece he created. This outro is the final version of Tail End, and Tyler offhandedly mentions the song during the Making of 9 Live special for VH1. You can actually hear the metal trash cans in the song as well.
Drums one day, when I had absolutely nothing to do, of course I only do this when the Kramer leaves, and I thought that we want to maybe get a little more tribal, you know? And I took that and I said, well, since I don't want to step on Joey's toes, what can I play that he can play that would enhance what he's playing? So I went out and I got a garbage pail. I turned it upside down and I did this thing. And I stuck it in the middle of a song called Crash and the tail end, and it burns. It burns.
Deep water. Now we're going to start this off with just a little bit of a something here. Every single picture on the side of this iceberg kind of related to something, and I've tried to show, yeah, this ties to this thing, this ties to that thing. Well, this level has so many entries that I decided to leave the picture on the side and not include its entry. But I will still explain it. Here's the explanation. Promo copies of the release of Live Bootleg have a neat error. These copies contain the original bat-style wings used on the 1974 albums of Get Your Wings. These copies are extremely hard to find and are a really cool collector's item, even if it's just the same album. No Room in My Heart. In 1987, during the Permanent Vacation sessions, there exists a demo called No Room in My Heart. This is a semi-country ballad duet, and it's believed that it's Steven and Loretta Lynn. A small snippet exists of the song, but no other information is available. Psy Collab. At a music festival in Singapore in 2013, Korean pop artist Psy met Steven Tyler and the two hit it off. This would lead to the two collaborating on a song. Psy told a magazine, "So for the first time ever, I will reveal a huge piece of information because I really appreciate being on the cover, so this is like a thank you. And the big secret is, I just finished recording my next song with a legendary artist, Steven Tyler of Aerosmith." In an interview later, he would also add, "The song has been completed, it's finished, but both Mr. Steven Tyler and I thought that we should make some changes. So we originally did want to release it now, but it's currently being reworked. The song was said to be in the same style as the 1986 Walk This Way cover that Joe Perry and Steven Tyler did with Run DMC. However, the song remains unreleased entirely, with no info on title or the song's content. And honestly, if somebody could find it and please send it to my girlfriend, that'd be amazing, because she won't stop bugging me about it. Damn, bam. In 1969, Joe Perry, Tom Hamilton, Pudge Scott, and later John McGuire formed a group called the Jam Band. They would play shows in the Hopedale area and would frequent the Barn, where bands like the Yardbirds and Chain Reaction would play. The group released one album, a self-titled debut, which remains completely lost. There are only four known copies to exist, likely in the hands of the original members. The album was a semi-live album recorded in the Barn in 1969. Its track listing is Rice Pudding, Shapes of Things, Let Me Love You Baby, Lose Deluxe, Red House, Ramblin' Rose, Gimme Some Lovin', and Milk Cow Blues. Notable is Rice Pudding is actually a rehearsal version and not actually live. This album was said to be poorly recorded and the audio mix was way out of whack, so it's unlikely the album will be released officially. There is a chance that it could be found unofficially, as Scott states that he had the album transferred to a few CDRs in the 1990s, and they could still be floating out there somewhere.
Joe and Tom decided to form a group of their own, and after a couple years of jamming, they're headlining the Barn themselves. In the summer of 69, they would come face to face with Steven Tyler, who had just returned home after yet another band breakup.
I was mowing the lawn over here, and back and forth and back and forth. I was damn near down to the bottom here. And I look over, and in from right over here pulls a little MG, and it's Joe Perry. And I say, hey, man, how you doing? Haven't seen you in a while. And he says, yeah, you know, we're playing up here at the Barn. I'm with a bunch of guys. I said, what are you doing tonight? I said, nah, nothing. Maybe I'll come over and see you. And as he drove off, I said, hey, you know, maybe we should play together sometime. And I know those words were passed. As fairy tale as it sounds, those words were passed.
With little else to do after mowing the lawn, Stephen went down to the Barn to catch Joe's jam band.
It was a god-awful show. I mean, they did stuff like going home, see my baby, just real fast and out of tune and just like, you know. And I was just getting ready to leave, and he went into, well, if you want to rock, the tom-toms and just, and I went, wait a minute, what is this? And it was so sexy and slow, and it wasn't this anymore. It was, you know, make it right and just, you know, now we're. It had such dynamics and it had such feeling that I realized if I can bring my father's classical and lay my own to that, we may have something. And here we are.
First bootleg confusion. In the Aerosmith bootleg circle, there is one argument that still rages on. What is the earliest bootleg's actual date? On live bootleg, the track Ain't Got You and Mother Popcorn are taken from a show at Paul's Mall in Boston. On the liner notes, the date is marked down as April 23rd, 1973, and it was simulcast on WBCN. The confusion arises from bootlegs such as Boston 1973, in which the date is listed as March 20th, 1973. The band did in fact play a show at this date at Paul's Mall, however this bootleg lists that its version, Ain't Got You and Mother Popcorn, were the ones that were included on live bootleg. There are also some sources that say that this show was also broadcast on WBCN as well, further adding to confusion. There is a bootleg from April 23rd called Early On in Boston that has the same exact set list. Upon listening to these recordings, it's clear that the recordings are the same. There is no known copy of the official March 20th show available yet, but some argue that Aerosmith's team got it wrong. I stand by the fact that it's the April 23rd show and hope somebody comes forward with the March 20th show. Fake outtakes bootlegs. In the early 2000s, during the dawn of the online downloading and during the height of passing around Aerosmith bootlegs, three bootlegs made the round on message board forums and fan sites. The track listings of these three CDs were a goldmine of unreleased songs and demos. The first was Pumping My Trash, and its track listing was mainly Pump songs that had gone unreleased, and the songs that were released on Pump that appeared on this album were extremely early versions. Notable here is a song called Branded, which is listed here twice. The only version that we have of this song available to the public is a 5-second clip. I'm going to see if I can play this one here. I'm going to double check, but if I can, I'll play it now. If not, you'll never know. Another one is Guilty Kitty, which eventually became Guilty Kilt. You can actually hear this song available on YouTube as well. The one that nobody knows exactly what it sounds like is Sister June. There is no clip of it available anywhere. News For You Baby is actually Hoodoo Voodoo Medicine Man. This was actually mentioned in Making a Pump. Then came Aerosmith Sessions 1991, 92, and 1994. Its track listing was bigger and even more enticing. The songs on this bootleg included songs from both the Get a Grip and Big One Sessions. All of these songs listed in this bootleg are all unreleased. They are not demos, except for, if you want to count them, Devil's Got a New Disguise and Legendary Child. Now, you can find Brass Balls, Great Moments, Legendary Child, and Wham Bam on YouTube as of right now. However, the songs Yo Mama, Meltdown, the demo for Devil's Got a New Disguise, Black Cherry, Lizard Love, all had clips available on YouTube, but have since become lost. We'll get into that later. As of right now, no clips exist of Two of Us, Keep On Moving, and Rocket 88. Then came the final bootleg in the trio, South Beach Connection, and it was a monster. Every song on this album was a highly sought-after demo or outtake. Notably, the only song from these sessions that have actually been performed live that we know of is Bacon Biscuit Blues being performed by Howard Stern, to which they mentioned that this song will be on the next album. There is clips of Trouble floating around, but all of these demos still have not seen the light of day as of right now. Immediately, skepticism poured in from everywhere. Fan sites that listed the bootleg were said to highly doubt they existed. To add to the controversy, these bootlegs were only made in batches of 100 and came from Brazil. Finally, it was discovered that the bootlegs were entirely fake after many of the song's titles could be easily found when searching through old band archives, documentaries, and song titles offhandedly mentioned in interviews. In the Making of Pump specifically, there are scenes with whiteboards in the background with song names on them. In the early 1990s, Aerosmith had clips of songs not yet released on Big Ones or Get a Grip listed on their website, and tons of interviews of the band with a name-dropped outtake, specifically Where the Sun Never Shines. So what was next? Was this the last chance anyone had to get Aerosmith outtakes from this bootleg, or Aerosmith outtake bootlegs from this era? Could this be the only time we ever come close? Could we trust whatever came out next? Was this the end of searching for Aerosmith bootlegs? Not exactly. In 2008, a CD popped up for sale on slcd.com. Selling for $500, the CD was said to be provided by an ex-Giffen employee. But after the last bootlegs of this nature being fake, it was doubted that it was real. Nobody wanted to pay $500 to find out. That was until a potential buyer got in contact with the seller and managed to get them to play the track Meltdown over the phone. A recording of this phone call did exist, but it is now lost. Unfortunately, sometime in 2008, the CD was bought reportedly by an Aerosmith team member, and the tracks have never surfaced. If anyone has any info on these last two topics, please let us know. The CD's track listing was Meltdown, Strange, Suzy Q, Don't Stop, Head First, Can't Stop Messing With It, Buried Alive, Sundona Sunrise, Ain't Enough, Guilty Kilt, and Sniffin'. Out of these 11 tracks, the only song that we have not heard a single clip from yet is Suzy Q. Strange has clips available, Meltdown did have clips available at one point, and I believe that Can't Stop Messing With It, Don't Stop, Head First, and Ain't Enough were all B-sides, with the only one being Can't Stop Messing that I'm not entirely confident of. Gonzalez. Gonzalez was the main source of many outtakes and demos being confirmed in the early 2000s. Gonzalez recalls while studying for an exam around 2000, he found the bootleg permanent outtakes and became obsessed. I was blown away. I felt like a spy that had infiltrated the recording studio while the band worked on the album, and that I could bring them back to the top of their popularity. In 2004, he began his own website on GeoCities called AerosmithOuttakes.com, where he hosted all of his information and the snippets made available from the Aerosmith website. This site became very popular to extreme Aerosmith fans and grew more and more intensive with each site update. Gonzalez would scour fan forums, tour sites, ex-producers' archives, as well as plenty of other sources until 2006, when he traveled to Hartford, Connecticut to see the band play. This is where he would meet up with an undisclosed private collector that he met on the Aero Force One forums and got a tour of the city while being able to hear full versions of the song. Gonzalez was ready and would take notes of the song's structure, key changes, and lyrics, and any other small details of these songs. After the Hartford show was canceled due to Steven Tyler needing throat surgery, he would return home to create covers of these outtakes to share with the world. These covers are still available and can be heard on YouTube and SoundCloud. Unfortunately, in 2008, patent law, Aerosmith's legal representatives contacted Gonzalez and requested he take down all audio files from his website and never re-upload them. As the years went on, Gonzalez has made many attempts to keep the information out there through a now-deleted wiki page and several websites. As of 2022, the Aerosmith back burner is one of the best places to find info on outtakes and lost projects from this band. And they contribute a heavy amount to this iceberg. And I'll get to them later. Walk in the Dig. After Aerosmith released its first album in 1973, the first 10,000 copies had a small misprint on the back, changing Walking the Dog to Walking the Dig. This is a huge collector's item, and can go upwards of $500 to $1,000 depending on the copy. Unplugged 2? On June 9, 1994, Aerosmith performed in Madrid, Spain, doing an entirely acoustic set much like the performance in 1990 for MTV. However, unlike the Unplugged program, this show was released only in Japan. Promo copies of Big One came with a CD of the five-song concert, and honestly, it's not a bad listen. It's shorter than most shows, but it's honestly good to hear some newer tracks from Get a Grip being played acoustically. If you want to find it, it's called Basico 40.
On the drums, he walks, he talks, he crawls on his belly like a reptile. Cream dog.
Almost Band. The band was almost named Spike Jones, Jack Daniels, Boone's Farm, Stitch James, and funnily enough, The Hookers, after Steven mentioned that playing at clubs was pretty much akin to being a hooker. Three Greatest Hits. During the show during the Back on the Saddle tour, Steven Tyler was so messed on drugs that he couldn't continue the show. To make up for the band's lack of a performance, fans were compensated with a free copy of Greatest Hits. Near Album Names. Get Your Wings was almost called Night in the Ruts, as mentioned before. Toys in the Attic was almost called Love at First Bite, Rock. Pump was almost called Bobbing for Piranhas, Elevator, F-I-N-E, Here's Looking Up Your Old Address, and Monkey House. Grit a Grip was almost called Pitbulls on Crack. Nine Live was almost called a whole lot of names that I am not going to say all of them. You can look at them. They're on the screen. Bada, 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 bada. There you go. Okay, that's enough. Boston got the record deal because of Aerosmith. In 1975, the band Boston acquired their recording deal with Epic Records after doing a live audition for record executives. This audition was held at Aerosmith's warehouse, their fan club headquarters that also doubled as a rehearsal space. Boston rented the place from Aerosmith, and the rest is history. Push Come to Shove is about Joe Perry. This one is kind of speculatory and comes from my brain. But honestly, if you look at the evidence, it's kind of crazy. Let's get into it. In 1982, on Rockin' a Hard Place, the closing song is a track called Push Come to Shove. And if you look closely at the lyrics, it makes a clear reference to Joe Perry. For context, in 1980, Joe Perry released his solo debut album, Let the Music Do the Talking. The lyrics from Push Come to Shove are as follows. Now, it gets even juicier with this line. The last song is up for debate, as many lyric sites have it differently. Joe Perry, though, however, would get the last laugh, because on the next Aerosmith album, the opening track was... Eric Cantor. Eric Cantor was a Republican congressman who had his team create a video that touted the unanimous vote on President Barack Obama's stimulus package. In this video, the song Back in the Saddle was used, and Aerosmith was very unamused by its usage and had the video taken down and sent a letter to Cantor. Here's a dramatic reading of this letter. Dear Representative Cantor, thanks for promoting our song about hooker Suki Joe. You and Suki were made for each other. You've moved up from being Chief Deputy Whip to Republican Whip in the 111th Congress. And her specialty was whipping bad boys like you. You and your Republican friends outflanked the Democrats in the stimulus battle. You showed them what a real stimulus plan should be about, didn't you, Mr. Republican Whip? Hookers, right? You left no doubt where your mind is when you picked our song. Maybe your constituents can't hear the words. But we know, like any song about a saddle sore cowpoke riding into a saloon town of soaking wet girls to get some time in the rack with this four-bit hooker. And we bet you're not the only one who thought it was funny when your staff sent out that old AFSCME with the bogus soundtrack full of obscenity. You, the bastion of conservatism, who always defends America with swear words. Bet your constituents on the Bible bet shot that joke. Hope you didn't bleep out all the good parts of our songs when you found out what we were singing about, but hey, you won't. That was your point, right? Of course, we almost did. Your friend, Senator David Fitter, he probably introduced you to old Suki. He knows all the hookers from New Orleans to Washington. Just imagine what you and Fitter get into on your foreign junk. Junkets? Where do you guys come up with these words? I bet the taxpayers are glad to pay for all of that. You guys need a break now and then. You're known for going on the House floor to rail against swear words and how they're destroying America. But with Suki, you can say all the bleeped words from the ads you and your staff promote. She'll spank your skinny butt every time you yell one. She'll even dress like your mother if you like that better than her leather boots and metal-studded pantsuits. Or is that what your mom wore, too? So get back in the saddle again, Mr. Whip, and beg Suki to whip you. Harder. Make it hurt. Your bad boy, Eric. Your buddies, Aerosmith. I shit you not, this is real. Like... the video is completely lost. Like, it's absolutely lost. I tried to find it. I think it was only up for 2 hours, so I doubt anybody backed it up. But I believe the letter in return of this lost video is a better trade. Unreleased from the Get a Grip era. In February 2009, YouTube user Aerovault uploaded three videos containing short snippets of Aerosmith outtakes. These videos were album-specific, and which were Pump, Get a Grip, and Nine Lives. However, sometime in 2011, the video was taken down by UMG under a copyright claim. I believe this is due to the soon-to-be-released Music from Another Dimension featuring the song When Harry's Child, which this video had a snippet of the demo in it. To my memory, the video included two snippets of Meltdown, some from the 2008 phone call, some studio, a snippet of Dime Store Lover, a snippet of Yo Mama, a longer snippet of Legendary Child, two snippets from Black Cherry, one made available from Aerosmith.com, one from studio, a snippet of 13, a snippet of Devil's Got a New Disguise, and a snippet of Strange. To this day, the video is entirely lost. I have a few links tied to the old lost Aerosmith outtakes videos that were blocked by UMG for Dime Store Lover in 13. And the 1991 demo of A Legendary Child is available in full, but the rest is completely lost. Three Billy Goats Gruff and I Love Trash. Steven Tyler appeared on the 1998 album Elmo Palooza with the track I Love Trash. He also did voice work for Reed Boston Presents Everyone Has a Story with his reading of Three Billy Goats Gruff. Both are still available.
And when the troll came clambering up over the side of the bridge, the billy goat charged and caught him on the sharp prongs of his horns and tossed his head so that the troll was thrown high into the sky and then hard down into the ground far beyond the green hill, and that was the end of him.
Worcester 82. During a bootleg from November 16, 1982, Steven Tyler passes out from the amount of heroin in his system and had to be dragged off stage. The band runs through Toys in the Attic before leaving the stage. This bootleg is significant as it's one of the only times captured for Steven Tyler passing out. As of right now, video footage does not exist.
And on November 16, 1982, drunk on gin and high on heroin, Steven Tyler would literally hit bottom in front of a crowd in Worcester, Massachusetts.
And I clearly remember being so dizzy and sitting down on the edge of the stage and could not get up, and I said, Tom, come here.
I remember Steven coming over toward me.
I wanted to, as a brother, hold him around the neck and say, I drank too f***ing much, man, fellas, I can't do the show.
I remember pushing him away like that.
And it fell down.
And then he ended up against the monitor. I thought he'd hurt his leg, and he slowly slid down it, disappeared behind the monitor, and went like, where's he gone? And I could see Tom Hamilton looking like this. That was sort of the end of the show.
We went up to the mic and said, that's all, folks. We're done for the night.
We'll be right back.
You See Me Cry and Dream On outro. Revealed on the newest record, a rehearsal from 1971, the original version of Dream On had You See Me Crying as the outro. In a similar vein as Layla, the song continues on after the last verse and into the first few bars of You See Me Crying before finally ending. Forgot Home Tonight. During a sound check with fans in 2002, the band asked for song suggestions, to which the crowd requested Home Tonight from the 1976 album Rocks. This song has never been played in full, and that is probably because the band doesn't remember how to play the song. Steven can play a few bars of the song on piano, but the band apparently doesn't remember. This is the only song not played from the album, and Leaves Rocks is not completely played despite it being a fan favorite.
Sorry. 11/25/1978.
During this bootleg at a show at the Spectrum in Pennsylvania, the band tries to begin the song Sight with Sore Eyes when it abruptly stops. This is because a bottle was thrown at the stage and shattered on one of the risers and sent shards of glass into Steven Tyler's face. This show does have a bootleg and is available on YouTube. This is just one incident in a long list of incidents of rowdy fans at the Spectrum, not only with Aerosmith. After this, Aerosmith would not return to the Spectrum until 1983.
Who wanna give you a good show, and we love you. You can't throw things at us. Please!
Ladies and gentlemen, Steven Tyler is hurt. The show will not continue. Please hold on to your ticket stubs. Just a minute. Quiet, please. Quiet, please. Let me finish. The band has left the building. There is nothing to be done. They are gone. The show will not continue tonight. Hold on to your ticket stubs. We will announce what will happen.
2 FM. It's a minute past 12 o'clock. Michael Tozzi till 3. Get into Q Classics now for this Saturday night, Sunday morning, an hour of Aerosmith. And, well, we had some unfortunate happenings tonight at the Spectrum. The Aerosmith show was cut short. They got on stage, played four or five tunes, and someone from the audience threw a bottle, hit Steve Tyler in the face again. Steve has not had good luck in the city of Philadelphia. He's last time they were in town, they played to a sold-out Spectrum. Someone threw an M80 or a cherry bomb or something on stage, injured him and another member of the band, and well, this time again.
Lord of Thighs bottle firecracker incidents. On two separate occasions during Lord of Thighs in 1983, fans threw objects at the stage. In Honolulu, a fan threw a firecracker, and Steven Tyler stopped the show to reprimand the crowd, but also took the chance to lighten the mood and sing Happy Birthday to Tom Hamilton.
Motherfuckers is an asshole this big. Now I'll tell you one thing. I'm glad that didn't go off down there. See, because I got off on it, right? Happy Feet? Right. But the next motherfucker that throws a firecracker up here, we're not gonna do anything to you. Shit, we're not violent. But the people around you, motherfucker, that throws it, is gonna eat your face off. And then throw it up here, and we'll trade it in for some cocaine or something. So it doesn't hurt him. We'll put the cocaine on his face. That's all. Because we don't do that stuff, right? For medicinal purposes only. Hold on, please. There's something else that's real important. It's been bothering me all night. Something else bothering me tonight. See, for some ungodly reason, it happens to be... See, the bass player over here is Tom Hamilton. Hey, we'll just keep it down, please. It's his birthday. So... I'd like to change the key. Let's just, hold on, just forget this song for a minute, right? You know the song, we know the song, right? All right, you motherfuckers better sing with me. One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear.
Also in 83, a fan threw a bottle on stage and Steven Tyler dragged the person on stage and made him sing "I Didn't Do It."
Hey! Did anybody see who threw that bottle? Bring him up here. Bring that motherfucker up here. Point him out to me. Where is he? Where is he? Show me him. Who was it? Who threw that fucking bottle? He did? You fucking asshole. Come up here. Come on up here and do some dancing with the big boys, motherfucker. Come on, baby. Come on, motherfucker. Let's go. Come on, baby. You think you know how to sing? Wait a minute. Don't hurt him. Just bring him up here. I want to see if he can sing. See if this fucking guy can sing, motherfucker. You gonna throw shit and see if you can sing. Let me hear you sing, motherfucker. Sing "I Didn't Do It."
Both of these shows have recordings and can be found on YouTube.
Bonus track!
Toys in the Attic was played in full in 2009. At Jones Beach in 2009, the band played the entire Toys in the Attic album and finally played You See Me Crying for the very first time. The show does have a video recording and can be found on YouTube. Queen. Throughout the years, there has been an ongoing rumor that stemmed from the 1970s. Queen and Aerosmith never got along. In 1976, Queen flat out refused to open for Aerosmith and the show had to be canceled. Later shows had Tyler and Queen arguing over who would help. However, that's all the information that I can find about this feud. Tyler mentions in his memoir that the night they had to cancel the show, but that's all that's mentioned. Queen also hasn't really made a comment on Aerosmith as well. Honestly, I just think the both of them had big egos. See, they're both great performers. So it makes sense that they wouldn't get along. Ventura 83. During this bootleg from August 3rd, 1983, Steven goes on a drunken rant during the show. This show was a mess, with Steven Tyler slurring the lyrics and trying to set this down from a usual 13 to 15.
15 songs down to only 10.
What the fuck's wrong with Tyler tonight? He's fucking so stoned he can't do shit. What would you do if you had 6 inches? 6 inches. My dick is bigger than 6 inches.
Steven Tyler tells me to shut the hell up. In 2006, a fan uploaded a video from the front row of an Aerosmith concert in which Steven Tyler leans down to the camera and tells the fans something unintelligible. The fan posts a video under "Steven Tyler tells me to shut the hell up." This really wouldn't be much to talk about, but the video went semi-viral, amassing 400,000 views in the first year it was uploaded. The consensus is that Steven Tyler isn't telling them to be quiet, rather telling the fan to turn that thing off, referring to the video camera. This is due to venues not allowing videotaping back then, and Tyler was trying to warn the fans security wouldn't have them thrown out. I'm going to play the video right here. What do you think?
I'm so
This was a band Steven Tyler was in, forming in 1969, and had the lineup of Steven Tyler on drums, Don Solomon on guitar, Eddie Christner on piano and vocals, and Peter Bover on bass. This band was said to play a crazy show, even getting them banned from opening for the Chicago Music Authority. The band was said to also have planned to record its own originals, but it's unknown if they got that far due to the band splitting up after 7 months due to Tyler's immense pressure on the band. Also, Fox Chase may have been Aerosmith's name revealed by a newspaper clipping, but this also could be false. This was the first band Joe Perry would join in 1906 with Bill Wright and John Alden. This band supposedly has a rehearsal film and is in the possession of the band. However, only a single picture of the band exists, being a frame from that film. It's unknown if they ever played any shows, but they did do several rehearsals before Joe would form the jam band. The last band Steven was in before meeting Joe Perry and Tom Hamilton. The band members were Steven Tyler on drums, Ray DeBano on guitar, and Dwight Tweedy Ferrin on vocals and guitar. The group disbanded sometime in 1969 after Steven Tyler attempted to strangle Tweedy for yawning during a rehearsal. Unfortunately, no pictures exist of the band in action.
Alright, I'd like to do a song that we did way back when. When I say way back when, just talking about a few years back, you know what I'm saying? This particular song is the first song I heard these guys play when I was a smart ass coming out of New York playing all the clubs. Jumped over my drum set, kicked the shit out of my guitar player and said, "F*** this." Hitchhiked up to New Hampshire. Met these guys, walked in this dingy, shitty place, out of tune, looking like, and they played this song.
So not much has changed.
In 1981, following mounting internal conflicts becoming especially tough after Joe Perry's departure, Joey Kramer would form a secret side band called Renegade. The lineup would be similar to the current Aerosmith lineup, with changes being Marge Raymond on vocals and Bob Mayo on rhythm guitar. With Tyler out of recording and performing after his motorcycle crash that year, 5 demos were recorded. These are One More Night, Do It Again, All Night Long, Badlands, and Cinderella Dreamer. The first 2 tracks were made available on YouTube by Raymond. Renegade did have a recording contract with SIR, but never played live. The project ended after Tyler recovered and pulled his band members away to finish the last 2 records contractually owed to CBS Records. Jimmy Crespo still owns the other demos and is at his discretion to whether they are released as of now. Okay, this is a big one. In 1994, Aerosmith closed up their Get a Grip tour with a show at the Boston Club and began work on their next album. The band wouldn't do any shows until 1997 when Nine Lives was released. But this isn't entirely true, as the band would perform two shows in 1995 under false names with no announcements. On November 9th and 10th, the band played a gig at the Middle East Club under the name Rayco and the Sea Covers and the G-Spots at Mama Kin's in Boston. They played a blistering set of old 70s tunes and songs that were planned to appear on the next album. Security was extremely tight for both nights, with metal detectors and even personnel smashing cameras and recording devices under strict orders to not let either show get bootleg. Some songs from that night would eventually become outtakes from Nine Lives and haven't been heard since. However, there are photos from both nights, and someone managed to snatch the set list from both nights as well. A fan, Lisa, recalled, "I found out about this show after calling into the fan club hotline, but the information had been leaked for only a few hours. Tickets could not be purchased over the phone. They could only be ordered in person at local record stores like Strawberry's Records. While it's almost completely confirmed that there is no recording of the Middle East show, there could be a recording of the Mama Kin show. At the time, the band had an in-house camera that recorded every show, so smaller bands send these recordings to record labels in hopes to boost their career. It is said that the camera did record that show that night, but the band has it locked in their Vindaloo vault and will not release the footage to anyone they do not trust. You cannot try and pay for this show either. You have to be somebody that the band knows personally that will not leak the footage. As of right now, all we have is these photos. One of them showing Joe Perry playing the song, Something. Now, I assume this so because Something did appear on Music from Another Dimension and has Joe Perry on lead vocals. It could also be the song Think About It or I'm a Man, but I'm heavily leaning towards it being Something, as Steven Tyler has mainly taken over vocals on those songs. Around 1983, three Aerosmith videos were produced for the songs Sweet Emotion, Bitches Brew, and Bolivian Ragamuffin. These videos are entirely lost, and the only evidence that we have is a 30-second clip posted by a user on MyGNR forums in 2010. These were believed to be put in trailers for Jaws 3D and debuted at New York City's Nightclub 54. No other info on these videos are available at this time, but it'd be really cool to see them found. These archives are full of unknown Aerosmith material, such as footage from their 1982 Miami sessions, interviews, and concert footage, all in HD. The only problem with Reeling in the Year is you have to submit a request for the videos for research purposes. On historic films, it's much of the same. However, the films are seemingly behind a paywall and a time limit, as $100 only gets you 60 minutes of footage, both of which I cannot afford at this moment. But it would be really cool to get in there and really see what they have in their listings, as some of them are really enticing. Historic Films has posted clips from the 1982 sessions, including a small snippet of Steven Tyler performing a demo of Darkness that would appear later on Done With Mirrors, and this footage is available on their website to view. However, much of their other films are, as mentioned before, still behind a paywall. In a London dumpster in 1998, a small box was found and contained a plethora of Aerosmith goodies. These included several DAT tapes, a digital audio tape, of finished original studio recordings, over 150 passport photos of the Aerosmith band and entire road crew for the Nine Lives tour, 37 different people and 5 picks per person, band backstage passes, 16mm slide films of hundreds of the highest possible quality photos of the band on and off stage, in the studio, and posing with props. This was originally posted on the AF1 fan forums around 2003 and caused quite a stir. A few DAT tapes contained released materials, while two DAT tapes were found to have six tracks, all demos and outtakes. The first tape contained one track being Sundona Sunrise with some new overdub, the same demo from the Pump Sessions in 1989. But the other one contained five different tracks. These tracks were Do You Wonder Why, Rough 1, Sun Never Shines, Rough 2, Rough 3. Rough 1 was said to be the demo of Give It Away or Push. Rough 2 was supposedly a semi-fast grunge song with the only lyrics being better. Rough 3 was said to be the working demo of Angel's Eye. Do You Wonder Why was eventually used by Joe Perry on his 2009 solo album, and Sun Never Shines is an earlier version of When the Sun Never Shines. These DAT tapes were lost to time, however silver CDs of these tracks still remain out there somewhere. In October of 2012, just before the release of their last album, Music from Another Dimension, the Aerosmith website was completely hacked. First showing an image of crossed arms, the site was locked up for a whole day. Then October 30th, the website was hacked again, this time with a message that in full appears to be lost. The message in part was, look, this was not easy for us to do. Okay, technically it wasn't too tough, but that's not what we mean. It was a tough decision to make as a band because we know we're causing you guys some headaches right now, and we love you guys. But what is an unknown band supposed to do today? How is a band supposed to get noticed? Pretty bizarre, huh? We are doing what we can to survive. We don't want to beg, borrow, or steal. But it's getting to that point. We're not just some band. We are good. We fucking rock. The band tied to this hack was never revealed, and to my knowledge, I don't even think they were really ever found. There are no leads, and there was no updates given about them afterwards. October 13th, 1970. Now this one is a true speculation entry. According to many websites and even Aerosmith themselves, the first paid Aerosmith gig was at Nipmuc High School on November 6th, 1970. But notice that the designation of being paid. One of the websites that I've been using to compile tour dates listed this date as first, October 13th, 1970, Boston, Massachusetts. Free performance staged outside the Boston University Student Union. I cannot find any other sources listing this date, but on the other hand, I can't find any really even mentioning this date. Any info on where it came from or where it could have come from will be greatly appreciated, as literally I don't even think the band themselves have even acknowledged this date existing.
Sex, guns, and Eskimos.
In 2006, Steven Tyler commissioned director-producer Casey Tebow to follow him around and record his life for a full year. Presumably, the recordings went from at least October 2006 to September 2007, covering the Root of All Evil tour and the World Tour 2007 Aerosmith tours from Steven's point of view. The footage featured Aerosmith shows backstage footage, Steven having fun in a hotel, shopping around the city with ex-girlfriend Erin, limericks and stories during a private flight between Steven and Erin, Steven playing drums with Russ Irwin on piano during a pre-show warm-up, Steven getting ready for a show during makeup, Steven arguing with an in-ear monitor engineer for not fixing his mix during the show, Steven walking the New York streets, Steven in Reno learning skin to duck, Steven in Memphis leaving a voicemail about guns, Steven adding his signature to random things in the city, Steven at a soundcheck, Steven doing a cappella Eskimo music with fans in Alberta. A small mock teaser trailer was also edited, hoping for a 2010 theatrical release. The film never came to be, and a 20-minute scissor reel, as well as the teaser, are lost along with the footage. When asked about the release, Tebow says that it's up to the band and management to decide. Steven mentioned the movie in his 2011 memoir, stating he did the whole European tour with us, but because he stayed with me and filmed me, some people in the band got a little jealous and knew that I was doing a movie. If I die, Casey has explicit orders to make all the clips into a movie and put the thing out so the world can see what goes on with me. But let's hope the film is released before then.
Dr. J. Jones, Ringo, and the G-Spots.
These are the fake names the band used to play private shows with new music being tested. Dr. J. Jones and the Interns was the first and most used throughout the 70s, and they played dates such as March 23rd, 24th, and 29th in 1978, again on July 19th and August 9th of that year, and then finally on June 30th in 1979. So March shows have certain tracks listed from them to be put on live bootleg, and the liner notes have them designated as such. They also played as Reiko and the Seat covers on November 9th and the G-Spots on November 10th in Boston. These were the private shows that I mentioned before. Now, I mentioned before Joe Perry selling and being gifted his prized 1959 Tobacco Sunburst Les Paul, but there's a similar story with an unhappy ending. In 1976, on the song Back in the Saddle, which featured Joe Perry on lead bass guitar. Sometime during the following tour, the bass was stolen and has not been seen to this day. It was believed to be a Fender Precision bass, but it's unknown where and when it was stolen.
Okay, now comes the cool, we're getting to the song-specific guitars. This is a six-string bass. It's like a small-scale bass. This is an Ernie Ball. This here is used on the song Back in the Saddle. Joe originally wrote it on a Fender, but that guitar was stolen many, many years ago. So this is what we have to replace. And it's amazing. Just got lots of growl, and it's got a Floyd Rose on it.
And what's the tuning on this one?
The tuning on this one is it's G. It's one whole step down. Standard tuning, one whole step down. And it's very growly. And of course, he actually plays lead on it, which is pretty amazing to watch him just, you know, going all over this thing. So that's very cool.
And what gauge strings do you have on that one?
These are 45 to 105. So, and you got to hear him just bend it, and it's pretty amazing. I love that. And through his amp rig, it sounds just all over the top. Sorry.
Stephen Tyler was arrested for swearing.
According to Stephen Tyler's memoir, on June 18, 1976, during a show at the Mid-South Coliseum in Memphis, Tennessee, a roadie tipped Tyler off to police showing up in droves to arrest him. During the song Mama Kin, Tyler told his road crew to kill the lights after it so he could make a clean getaway. But police captured him in the lobby, guns drawn. From his 2011 memoirs, thrown to my stomach, foot on my neck, gun to my head, he said, "Now you're doing double for saying the word fuck." He grabbed me and threw me in the back of a car, and I wound up in a cold dank cell for 3 hours. The lawyer called me up and found out that they had set bail to 10 grand. Later, back in the hotel, smoking a bone, I thought to myself, "Sweet Jesus, I am never doing that again." Then looked in the mirror, smiled and said, "Oh yes, I will."
All or nothing.
This appeared out of nowhere on an old Wikipedia article for Aerosmith outtakes listed as All or Nothing, B-side to Chiquita. Now the odd thing is that Chiquita was never released as a single, but did have a music video produced for it in 1979. There is no info, heads or tails, about what this song is or where it came from. It could have been an outtake planned to be the B-side for Chiquita, as there's only one single from Night in the Ruts being Remember Walking in the Sand. But honestly, I can't find any info on this one either. In 2011, Burger King blackmailed Tyler into doing several commercials for them, stemming from Tyler writing the lyrics. Olivia Ragamuffin for Rockin' a Hard Place. This being stolen from a jingle that Burger King would use in the 1970s.
Hold the pickle, hold the lettuce, special orders don't upset us. All we ask is that you let us serve it your way.
This blackmail would lead Tyler down a dark path of mindlessly consuming Whopper burgers, leading to him having to leave American Idol due to his incessant onion ring craving. This also resulted in Tyler joining Fast Food Anonymous Rehab in 2012 after nearly beating Joey Kramer to death after he finished his chicken fingers. Or I completely made this up.
Exciting things are happening at Burger King. Hey!
The new crispy chicken strip.
This was a licensed map made for the site worlds.com, released in 2001 and is still in working order today. However, that can only be said about the servers of world.com, as the only way to access this map was through a paid membership program. In this world, there was a diner, a citadel, the Boneyard recording studio, as well as a stage where the band would perform. Other features of purchase were 1 year VIP access to Aerosmith World, email, enter lotteries for tickets at select Aerosmith shows, interact avatar to avatar with Aerosmith in AI rooms, become an avatar, guaranteed access to all to select Aerosmith webcast, voice chat. You may even get a chance to speak with the band online, discount to exclusive Aerosmith.com and AI merchandise, be awarded with AI points just for hanging out, exclusive AI contests with kick-ass prizes, seniority that gets you the best shot at everything that's good to get, win your own room in Aerosmith World for a month, AI's poster zone, a personal web space in on AI. Oh my god. A limited edition AI decoder laminate, which you hold up to the screen to see if you've won prizes, if you have won prizes and contests with Aerosmith.com. What in the world? Entry to the VIP-only Aerosmith Media Lounge, access to rare Aerosmith archival material, win a chance to have your picture posted in Aerosmith World, AI subscribers only message board, and a virtual backstage pass to select shows during the tour. Membership was available until 2013. It seems like there's no way to get back into this world. I've tried signing up for the service, but the Wayback Machine hadn't archived the payment option page. If anybody knows how to work worlds.com and can find a way to get onto the server, let me know because I'd love to see what we can find.
Oh yes, you can't type 100 words. Online session about his typing skills.
Gee, Tom, how fast do you type?
In the song Flesh, released on Get a Grip, the man in the intro is not credited or has any information on what the context is that he's saying. There's not even a transcription of what he says. My interpretation is,
and actually put her hand on mine, and as she touched me,
if anybody can figure out what he's saying, I'd love to know. Because this sounds like a transcript from some kind of interview or interrogation footage or something like that, because it has that grainy quality of an interrogation recorder. But there is no credit given to who this is. It could be somebody in the band and we never know. In 1986, Rick Rubin helped Aerosmith gain a huge boost in popularity by having them collab with Run DMC on Walk This Way. This would happen after they had Rick Rubin help produce their next record, which began work that year. However, Rubin later recalled that in a now-deleted tweet that the sessions went nowhere and they ran out of time. Be that as it may, the band still recorded five new songs: Love Me Like a Bird Dog, Take It Easy, One Time, Joe's Funky, and Hollywood. None of these songs would be used for the actual next album, being Permanent Vacation in 1987, this time produced by Bruce Fairburn. These outtakes are available on YouTube, except for One Time, which usually has a hard time staying up on YouTube. As a neat little side bit, there are two versions of Hollywood, one supposedly from these sessions and one supposedly from the Permanent Vacation sessions with Bruce Fairburn. They have two different sounds, only a snippet of the other one actually exists. In 2009, rumors began flying that Aerosmith would be making a new album that would be out that year. This was confirmed by Tom Hamilton, who said, "The big news is that we had our first meeting and strategy session with our new producer, Brendan O'Brien. We've been wanting to work with him for a while. The meeting came on the heels of the band all working together for the first 2 weeks. Things are moving along, and now it's on the fast track. We had a day where we all got to listen to everyone's songs and ideas. In the next few weeks, we'll be narrowing down what we got. We can already see things coming into focus, even as new ideas are popping up left and right." However, these sessions would not go well, as it came to light that Perry and Tyler were snorting pills and Tyler not getting along with O'Brien. "He came into our session and set up a piano," Tyler told Rolling Stone, "trying to come up with parts, songs that I wrote." Brad Whitford told Rolling Stone, "It's a very sad moment we had. The gentleman we had on number one on our wish list, and it was very exciting for us to be working with O'Brien. I don't think it lasted more than 2-3 weeks. He bent over backwards to do whatever he could to make Steven comfortable. As I recall, he didn't like working with Brendan. You couldn't ask for a nicer person and a more talented musician and producer than Brendan." These sessions would continually get delayed by Tyler as well, by not showing up or not wanting to work. The album would also get delayed due to the ZZ Top tour and various incidents and infighting with the band that almost led to Tyler getting replaced. In 2010, the album was canceled and the material was forgotten.
"Rehearsal for the new record. We are working with Brendan O'Brien. It's going really good. And I'm here to report that we are going to have a new
Rock and a Hard Place 2. A new writing session took place with the replacement members, Crespo and Dufay, after the release of Rock and a Hard Place. Songs written were meant to be used by that alternative lineup of the band. It's said that they had almost a CD's worth of songs, but reportedly not finished due to Tyler not being able to reform or write lyrics during most of those sessions. One song known from this album was a song called Written in Stone, which eventually would be released by Rick Dufay. The album never really took off, as Tyler was suffering heavily from his addictions and at the time was unable to write or perform at all. It is believed that some of these songs may have been taken to Renegade, but this is unconfirmed. Eventually, material was abandoned as Tyler and Perry were in talks to reunite the band. Greatest Hits Live was an Aerosmith album recorded between 1993 and 1994. It was scheduled to come out in 1995, but ultimately never released. American producer and engineer Kevin Olsen was brought on board to manage the recordings of a host of concerts and ultimate production of this live compilation album. This live album was completely mixed and mastered and was ready for release, but internal problems in the band led to its shelving. It was possibly shelved as the band already had plans to go into the studio, what would result in 9 Lives, and the label didn't want to interfere with new album sales. This was later found out after Olsen put the notes and factors up for auction on Backstage Auction, this being the planned track listing. This idea wouldn't entirely fade, however, as evidenced by 1998's album Little South of Sanity.
Mike, you're on.
How you doing, guys?
Good.
Hey. All right,
I was wondering, it's been a while since your last live album, if you were going to have one after this tour.
Ah,
man, so many people are asking about that. You know, We did record a bunch of gigs. We haven't decided what we're going to do with it yet. We just got to the point where we thought we were playing really good and we should have it on tape, but we have no plans right now.
But we got 4 or 5 shows that are in the oven.
Okay. Cooking.
All right. Well, let's tell you about some more shows that are going to be cooking real soon.
After the success of 1990's Making a Pump documentary, an idea was to record the band's entire process, from concept to writing, recording, releasing, and touring the new album, and premiere it as a follow-up became a slight reality. Aerosmith's manager at the time, Tim Collins, spearheaded the idea and had a video crew follow the band around the studio and in LA as they work and rehearse new tracks. Footage included discussions with producer Bruce Fairbairns and Collins, as well as co-writers with Desmond Child, and even backstage clips from their 1993 tour. Perhaps difficulties in the making of Get a Grip got in the way of the project, and it was eventually abandoned. Recordings took place from December 91 to at least September 1992, and were put up for auction on Gotta Have Rock and Roll with a starting bid of $4,000. The auction house was kind enough to supply 2 clips of the footage. The auction closed on April 30th, 2022, with a winning bid of $5,000. As of now, the only footage we have of this documentary are the supplied clips, and nothing else has surfaced. Now, it is reported that it could have been bought back by Aerosmith's management team, and hopefully a full documentary comes to fruition, and soon.
It sounds like it should be somewhere in the middle of the song. It's just too... It's
like that.
It's saying something, but it's not personal. It's like coming in the middle of the argument. You know, what the fuck started the argument to begin with? Or what's, you know... It's not taken back far enough. You know, like there was my own girlfriend that has another dying ring. I mean, that's a step away, but at least you set it up like, oh, so that's what's happening here. It's like, you say you're leaving on 7:30?
Yes. Absolutely. That's very, you know.
Matter of fact.
It's just, we the whole picture's right there. The kind of girl it is, you, the whole thing.
Really, it's like, oh, so you're leaving, bitch.
Exactly.
Please, take the TV, but leave the pussy. Okay, I mean, that's a sideways, but it is, it's kind of sort of clubbing over the head. You know.
Does it sound just like the bass playing on the Jeff Beck album?
Probably.
You know, it's like that would be the bass kind of thing.
So,
did you get introduced?
Yes, I
yes.
Did.
So, the purpose of today is to kind of introduce Alan and have a great kind of just check in and chat a little bit.
In 2006, an outtake-based album began production at the Boneyard. As revealed in a short clip that documented the process of making Sundona Sunrise and Devil's Got a New Disguise, the band had chosen a large section of their outtakes catalog to put on this album, including Your Mama, Black Cherry, Bacon Biscuit, Dime Store, and Innocent Man. However, this idea would fizzle to just being two new tracks being included on the Best Of compilation Devil's Got a New Disguise. There is no given reason on why or what caused this album to be semi-canned. On October 28, 2013, Gerardito Jones brought to everyone's attention that during the VH1 special, footage from a mystery 1974 show of the band was used. In the short clips that we can hear, the band is performing Train Kept a Rolling and Woman of the World. Some fans have speculated that this could be from Winterland in December of 1974, and some also pointed it could be from the collector named Bill Graham. However, as of now, nobody or anything else has come forward about this footage.
And I went, wait a minute, what is this?
First time I heard Joey play, I was like, wow, if we can get that guy, we'll be good.
I'm not a technical player. I don't play real fancy. I do one thing really, really good. It's about my gut. It's about what I feel inside. That's all that I have to go on. Hey, that's a good thing to do now. Do the shake. It had such dynamics and it had such feeling that I realized if I can bring my father's classical and lay my own to that, we may have something.
But just as Aerosmith was reveling in its first taste of success, the Brotherhood was severely bruised.
I clearly saw that Joe was pulling away, and it really bugged me.
Joe Perry was spending more and more time away from the band in the company of his girlfriend, Alyssa Jarrett. Alyssa's constant presence aggravated an already tense environment on the road, where increasing drug use was breeding resentment and jealousy.
You know, there was some more anger there. I mean, here's a guy that I've been waiting all my life to have as a friend, never mind be in a band. And he was cool looking, had long black hair. And he really doesn't give a shit about me. He'd rather be off with Alyssa, who was a fox. And looking back in retrospect, I don't blame him because he was getting laid and I wasn't.
I mean, the sexual tension between Steve and
Alyssa and Joe Perry. Back then, I mean, it was incredible. And they played with it.
And finally, one that I seem to be the only one able to spread info on this topic. On March 12, 1986, Aerosmith performed at the Centrum in Worcester, Massachusetts. During the song She's on Fire, Steven mentions,
I want to hear some singing tonight, you know, we're recording this for an album.
However, this album never came out. The only track that made it out of the show was Let the Music Do the Talking, appearing on Classics Live Volume 2 in 1987. However, I don't think that this show was recorded solely for Classics Live, as a majority of that album is from a show from December 31st, 1984, with an outlier being Draw the Line from 1978. I stand by the belief that Aerosmith recorded the show with a specific purpose of putting it out as a live album, but with how badly Done With Mirrors tanked in November 1985, just 5 months earlier, they ultimately decided against it, but still put Let the Music Do the Talking on Classics Live 2. The only real evidence backing up my claim is that the December 19th show at Mama Kin's in 1994 was also recorded, only had one song thrown on an EP called Made in America. As we saw before, there were plans to do a live album in 1994 that also got canned. So maybe they did record the show for a full live album, or it was supposed to be a show used for Classics Live 2. There is no concrete evidence hither or t'other.
And so concludes the Aerosmith Iceberg. This has been a massive labor of love, as it's my favorite band, and I've been such a nerd about this band since the early 2000s. Big thanks to Sade for helping me proofread what was a massive wall of text of a script, as well as making sure that every one of these topics actually makes sense and is worth putting on the iceberg. A huge shout out to AerosmithBackburner.com, where a good amount of the lower section of the iceberg came from. I seriously keep checking that thing every single day. So whoever runs that, I know there's a team of people that run that. You guys, like, good work. Keep up the good work. If you guys want to check it, I'll put it in the description below. Huge shout out also to Christopher Eriksson. Christopher Eriksson. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right. He's from Denmark. It is from Denmark. And his website, Walk Rock This Way. He's been managing this website. And I don't think managing, actually. I think he's just been, you know, keeping the site alive for the last, like, 20-some years. The last update was in, like, 2002, I think. And, actually, no, I think it was later than 2002. I think it was 2004, because he has Honkin' on Bobo on there. But either way, he's been keeping the site alive for the longest period of time. And he may not be updating it, but he's still, like, the bills are getting paid and the site is staying up. And it's a seriously good treasure trove and sort of time capsule of Aerosmith fandom, fan stuff from, like, the early 2000s. It's a great look at. I'll have that one listed in the description below as well. Thanks to anybody who created a fan site or an Aerosmith fan forum at any point. I just know that if you had one, there is most likely a chance that I fired up the Wayback Machine and was scrubbing your fan site for any kind of information whatsoever. And there's probably a good amount of stuff that came from those fan sites that have been added to here. Also, just a big thank you to all the YouTube channels that have uploaded Aerosmith material in the last couple of years, and have, like, you know, kept things updated and kept things not kept things updated, but kept things uploaded, because there are so many videos and so much stuff that has been taken and used for evidence, sources, anything like that. Like, cause without you guys, like, most of this iceberg would just be me just, you know, grabbing ideas out of the void, pretty much. Especially to a special thanks to Gonzalek. Gonzalek had still has a great YouTube channel. I think he's one of the main contributors to the Aerosmith Backburners, because I see him in the YouTube channel as well, posting stuff. He's done a great job. Like, he's the main spearheader. Like, he's still, like, special thanks to him. I think that's everybody that I can think of off the top of my head. So what's next? What is next? Well, I have a few other ideas that I'm thinking about right about now. Lost Media is popular, so I might do a Lost Media video next. If anybody can figure out how to run worlds.com, I'd love to do a live stream or maybe a couple of videos exploring worlds.com to do that. I guess my main question is next, should I start a Patreon? Because I obviously can't really monetize a lot of stuff on here, but I can, make a Patreon where you guys suggest ideas for me or whatever. And I can do that. I also do know that there are a lot of there will most likely be a follow-up Iceberg video sometime in the future. Not next. The follow-up is not going to be next. That's going to take way too long. I started this project in October of last year, so I genuinely do not want to do this again for a while. This has been the best of times. It's been the worst of times. I don't want to do this again. Not for a while, at least. It was fun, but I'm ready to do something else for a little bit. But I do know that there are some things that I miss, like the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and there are the, oh my goodness, there's so many other things that I miss, like their Let's Get Loud appearance on the ESPY Awards, and there are many other football side appearances with like Hank Williams Jr. with all my rowdy friends are coming over on Monday night or whatever it was. There's that. So, there's stuff I miss. Of course there's going to be stuff that I miss. This is a very long list. I think the final total was like 152, and I think at that point I was like, if I add anything more, I'm going to hurt myself, because it's just too much. I will say though, however, that this has been a lot of fun. Also, a couple corrections I want to make. With the Done With Mirrors canceled live album, I want to add this in here. With the Done With Mirrors canceled live album, they did put two tracks. I think so. They put three tracks. So I'm thinking about it now. It's the Darkness EP that they put out in 85. They had My Fist Your Face, Sheila, and The Hop on that EP, which came out after the record. It didn't come out in 85. It came out sometime in 86. But just, yeah. So they definitely recorded that show, and they had a lot of love towards that show, but they just... I guess the record just didn't do well, and so I'm gonna say right now, don't expect a video other than maybe the GTA clips for a couple of days while I'm working on the next video. I have no set idea right now for when the next episode's gonna come out, but it'll most likely be a Lost Media episode. But also I may put up a poll, for whether or not you guys want me to, whatever you guys want me to do next. So, time will come, So with that, that concludes the Aerosmith Iceberg. I hope you had a lot of fun. I hope you enjoyed watching. Thank you so much for being here and sitting through this thing. I know this thing. Actually, I do know what the next upload is. The next upload will be the full thing from start to finish in one full video. It'll be like 3 hours long probably, but I know that one will be good for people to watch, put in the background, and just listen to me ramble on topics. So, that'll definitely be the next Aerosmith-related thing on this channel. The other next thing on this channel will most likely be GTA clips. So,
until then, I will say thank you for watching, and I hope to see you guys in the next video. So, yeah, thank you.